Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
Gildan Audio presents an unabridged recording of Genghis Khan, His Conquests, His Empire, His Legacy by Frank McLynn. Narrated by Timothy Andres Pabon. To the four important ladies in my life, Pauline, Julie, Lucy, Ellen. Glossary of Principal Personalities. Please note that almost all dates in early Mongol history are somewhat conjectural. Alahush, died in 1212, chief of the Ongud, revealed the Naiman plan of attack to Genghis in 1205, assassinated by a rival faction in the Ongud while Genghis was in China. Altan, dates unknown, third son of Hutula, pretender to the Khanate, jealous of Genghis, his cousin, and habitually and systematically treacherous, said to have alienated Jamuga from Genghis. Ambagai, reigned from 1149 till 1156, of the Taichiud clan, Khan of the Mongol Confederation, crucified by the Jin Chinese. Arslan, dates unknown, chief of the Harluks, who lived in the region of the Black Irtish. Formerly a vassal of Harahitai, he defected to Genghis in 1211. Aza Gambu, died in 1227. Anti-Mongol Tangut noble, appointed both prime minister and commander-in-chief by Emperor Xian Tsung of Xixia, reigned 1223 to 1226. Barchuk, died sometime after 1227, the idikate or ruler of the Uyghurs, switched allegiance from Harahitai to Genghis in 1209 and was given one of his daughters in marriage. One of Genghis's most trusted and valued allies, fought in the Tangut campaign of 1227. Batu, lived circa 1207 to 1255, son of Jochi and founder of the Golden Horde dynasty, commander-in-chief of the Mongol invasion of Europe in 1236 to 1242, loathed the great Khan Guyuk and was close to civil war with him when Guyuk died, allied with Sorhaktani Beki to secure Mongke's election. Begter, lived circa 1156 to 1180, son of Yasuge and his unknown first wife, Genghis's half-brother, but murdered by him. Belgate, lived circa 1158 to 1252. Brother of Begter and Genghis's half-brother, remained scrupulously loyal to Genghis and performed well as a general, though was notably indiscreet and thus excluded from the Mongol council and top-level decision-making. Boorchu, lived circa 1162 to 1227. First and most loyal of Genghis's friends, one of the four steeds, saved Genghis's life and was a notable general, particularly close to Ogade, died during the Tangut campaign of 1227, possibly of Parkinson's disease, or maybe complications arising from epilepsy or Meniere's disease. Borohul, lived circa 1162 to 1217. One of Hoelun's adoptees and one of the four steeds, second only to Boorchu in Genghis's personal esteem, saved Ogade's life at the Battle of Halhaljid Sands, killed on campaign against the forest peoples. Borte, lived circa 1161 till 1230. Genghis's official wife and mother of four sons and five daughters begotten by Genghis, a woman of notable wisdom and one of Genghis's most trusted advisors. Bujir, lived circa 1200 to 1264. Was with Jebe and Subade on the Great Raid of 1221 to 1223, later a senior Mongol administrator in China. John Aplano Carpini, lived from 1182 till 1252. Franciscan friar, later archbishop, The first significant Western envoy to the Mongols in 1246 to 1247, when he acted as the representative of Pope Innocent IV. Chagatai lived circa 1184 to 1242. Genghis's second son, headstrong, quarrelsome, and fanatically anti-Muslim, he was the least impressive of Genghis's sons and did a lot of harm by his vendetta against Jochi. Qin Hai lived circa 1169 to 1252. Of uncertain racial origin, among the Mongols, Turk was used as a catch-all term. He was the great peacetime administrator of the Mongol realms. Genghis's chief minister, he also served the great Hans Ogaday and Gulyuk in that capacity. Dai Sechen. Exact dates for his lifespan are unknown. Chief of the Bozkir clan of the Angirad tribe. Genghis Khan's father-in-law, he was honored at the 1206 Huriltai. Daritai. Dates for his lifespan are unknown. Genghis's paternal uncle. Made common cause with Altan and Huchar. Caught up in the disgrace of Belgate. Dorbe Dokshin. Dates for his lifespan are unknown. Chief of the Dorbin clan, a general with a reputation for merciless ferocity. Eljigade. Birth date unknown, he died either in 1251 or 1252. Scholars dispute whether there was just one Mongol with this name, or two, probably two given the relevant dates. The Eljigade extant at the beginning of the 13th century was the executioner of Jamuga. The one who died in 1251 or 1252 was executed for disputing the election of Mongke. Chronology seems against a single Eljigade, but we can refer to the career of Temujin. Hoelun lived circa 1142 to 1216. Wife of Yasuge, who had five children with her, including Genghis, one of Genghis's most trusted advisors, later married to Monglik. Hulagu lived between 1218 and 1265. Son of Tolwi and Sorhaktani Beki, grandson of Genghis, brother of Erik Buke, Mongke, and Hubalai Khan. Founded the Ilkhan dynasty in Persia in 1256, sacked Baghdad in 1258. Jamuga. He lived between 1161 and 1206. Of the Jadarad clan. Childhood friend and blood brother to Genghis and rival for leadership of the Mongols. May have been a double agent. His habitual ambivalence led to his eventual downfall and execution. Jebe. He lived circa 1180 to 1225. Of the Besud subclan of the Taichiud Mongols. Wounded Genghis with an arrow in battle in 1201, but was pardoned and became one of his star generals. Cooperated brilliantly with Subadai on the Great Raid of 1221 to 1224. Jelme lived circa 1170 to 1207. Elder brother of Subadai, an important general, saved Genghis's life by sucking the blood from his neck after he had been wounded by an arrow. Singled out for special favor at the 1206 Huriltai. Died campaigning against the Naiman. Jochi lived circa 1182 till 1227. Eldest son of Genghis, though Genghis was almost certainly not his natural father. Accusations of illegitimacy dogged him throughout his life. Espousing a more liberal view of empire than his father, he became estranged from Genghis, was suspected of plotting against him, and eventually done away with on his orders. Jurchaday. Dates for his life are unknown. Chief of the Uruud tribe, who switched sides from Jamuga to Genghis in 1201, given the Karayate princess Ibahabeki as wife, father of Kete and Bujir. Kokochos. Dates for his life are unknown. Of the Ba'arin clan, and apparently named after a secret Mongol ritual, was appointed minder to Chagatai, and tried in vain to keep the peace between him and Jochi. Louis IX, St. Louis, who lived between 1214 and 1270, reigned from 1226 on. The only canonized king of France, went on the Seventh Crusade in 1248 and the Eighth Crusade in 1270. Monglik. Dates for his life are unknown. Close friend of Yesuge. Under Genghis, granted the honorific title of Spiritual Father. Disgraced after Genghis had his son, Chief Shaman Teb Tengeri, also known as Kokochu, killed for treason. Muhali. Lived between 1170 and 1223. Genghis's only undefeated general. The mastermind behind Genghis's eventual conquest of Jin China. Appointed viceroy of China and de facto deputy Han in 1217. Naya'a. Dates for his life are unknown. Son of Shirkutu, chieftain of the Bahrain clan, one of the important Mongol generals, praised by Genghis for not breaking his oath to Targatai of the Taichiud. Ogaday. Lived circa 1186 to 1241. Genghis's third son and his successor as Great Khan. Generous, charismatic, but capriciously cruel, he expanded the Mongol Empire to its greatest extent, with conquests in China, Korea, Central Asia, Russia, and Eastern Europe. Scholars dispute whether he and his beloved brother Tolui died of alcoholism or were poisoned. Marco Polo lived between 1254 and 1324. Venetian merchant and traveler, the most important Western traveler to visit Kublai Khan's China, was absent from Venice, traveling in the Orient from 1271 to 1295, clocking up 15,000 miles. Habul reigned from 1130 to 1146 of the Borjigit clan, Khan of the original Mongol Confederation, Genghis's great-grandfather. Hasiyun lived from 1166 to unknown date. Yasuge's third son with Hoelun, little is known of him except that he was personally closest of all the brothers to Genghis, father of Eljigide. Hasar lived between 1164 to circa 1216. The most disloyal and treacherous of Genghis's brothers, a man of great physical strength and a superb archer, frequently plotted against Genghis and enjoyed an up-and-down relation with the Khan. Kublai, dates for his life are unknown, of the Barulas tribe, a senior Mongol general, not to be confused with the later Mongol Khan and Chinese Emperor Kublai Khan. Huchar, dates for his life are unknown. Nephew of Yesuge and pretender to the Khanate, he and Altan habitually plotted against Genghis. Huduha, dates for his life are unknown. Chief of the Oyirad, one of the forest peoples. Originally Jamuga's right-hand man, but joined Genghis after the defeat of the Naiman. Performed unsuccessfully in the Tumid Rebellion of 1217, and was taken prisoner by the dynamic Botohui, the Boudica of the Tumid. After her defeat, he took her as one of his wives. Hukluk, died in 1218, son of the Tayang Khan of the Naiman. Hutula, reigned between 1156 and 1160, of the Borjigit clan. Khan of the Mongol Confederation, died fighting the Tartars. William of Rubric, lived circa 1220 and died circa 1293. Flemish Franciscan, served with Louis IX of France on the Seventh Crusade and was his envoy to the Mongols in 1254. Shigihutuhu, lived circa 1180 till 1250. A Tartar adopted when a boy by Hoelun, one of Genghis's special favorites, de facto chief justice of the Mongol Empire under both Genghis and Ogaday, literate, and said to have been the first Mongol notable to master the Uyghur script. Sorhanshira, dates for his life are unknown. Of the Suldus tribe, a minor chieftain who helped the youth Genghis to escape from Targatai of the Taichiud, who had yoked him with a Khang. rewarded at the 1206 Horiltai by being appointed one of the Orlogs. Sorhaqtani Beki lived circa 1187 till 1252. Daughter of Jahagambu, brother of Togrul and thus a Karaite and Nestorian Christian, a master politician, one of the most influential and intelligent women of the age, wife of Tolui and mother of three Mongol Hans, one also a Chinese emperor, Mongke, Hulagu, and Hubilai, managed to secure the succession for Mongke in alliance with Batu. The Syriac scholar Bar Hebraeus said of her, "If I were to see among the race of women another woman like this, I would say that the race of women was far superior to that of men." Subadei lived between 1175 and 1248. A member of the Uriang-hai tribe, allegedly the son of a blacksmith, served Genghis and Ogedei brilliantly from 1192 to 1248. A superlative general, one of the greatest of the age, he was the Mongols' master strategist. Taratonga. Dates for his life are unknown. Tangut administrator who introduced the Uyghur script to the Mongol court, appointed tutor to Genghis's sons, and made keeper of the royal seal. Tebtengeri, also known as Kokochu, birth date unknown, died circa 1208, chief shaman of the Mongols, backed Genghis to the hilt until 1206, but after the 1206 Horiltai, tried to assert himself as the equal of Genghis. After the attempt to discredit Genghis's brothers, the Han had one of them break his back in a de facto execution. Temujin, also known as Ochigin, lived between 1168 and 1246. Least warlike of Genghis's brothers and criticized by him for laziness, he was a skilled politician with intellectual and cultural interests, executed after trying to seize the throne from Güyük. Temulun, born either in 1169 or 1170, date of death unknown. Genghis's sister. Little is known of her except that she made an exogamous marriage with Palchuk of the Ongirad. Togrul, also known as Ong Han, born circa 1140, died 1203. Ruler of the Karaite, a Nestorian Christian, a turncoat and intriguer, involved in a complex three-way relationship with Genghis and Jamuga before his defeat and death. Tolui lived between 1192 and 1232. Genghis's fourth son and the greatest general of the four. Genghis considered him too cautious to be an effective great Han. Extremely close to Ogedei, and like him, died either of alcoholism or poisoning. His sons Hubilai, Hulagu, and Mongke were all distinguished Mongol rulers. Toktoa Beki, birth date unknown, died in 1208, ruler of the Merkit tribe and a doughty opponent of Genghis in the early days, had a reputation for being excessively bloodthirsty. Tohuchar, birth date unknown, died in 1221. Genghis's son-in-law, sacked Tus, contrary to Genghis's orders, demoted, then killed during the siege of Nishapur. Prince of Wei Shao lived between 1168 and 1213. Seventh of the 10 Jin emperors under the name Wan Yen Yong Qi, third and last of them to be assassinated. Yelu Chu Kai lived between 1190 and 1244. Khitan aristocrat, a superb administrator and a strong influence on both Genghis and Ogedei, supervised the census and tax system in China in the 1230s. Yesuge, birth date unknown, died in 1171. Father of Genghis, a subchief, but never a Mongol Han. Author's note. I think it obvious that a definitive biography of Genghis Khan is impossible. The Platonic ideal of a Mongol scholar would have to master, at a minimum, Mongolian, Chinese, Persian, Arabic, Russian, Hindi, Urdu, and Gujarati and preferably also Japanese, Polish, Hungarian, and the multitudinous dialects of the many worlds into which the Mongols penetrated, Vietnam, Burma, Indonesia, Siberia, Georgia, Azerbaijan, etc., etc., it would take a single human being several lifetimes to master all these tongues before he or she could begin to set pen to paper. This is why scholars of the Mongols tend to specialize in discrete areas and produce books on the Mongols and Russia, the Mongols and China, the Mongols in Iran, the Mongols in the West, and so on. I have not learned any of the difficult languages I just mentioned, and my modest, though still taxing, project has been to produce a synthesis of all the scholarship done in the major European languages in the past 40 years relating to Genghis and his sons. There will doubtless be many things professional Mongolists will object to, but I hope I have covered Genghis's life in sufficient detail. I have not just concentrated on the blood and guts of his notoriously bloody campaigns, but also layered in, without, I hope, overwhelming the reader, enough discussion of Mongol society, culture, ideology, and religion to make the narrative more than just one damn battle after another. My debt to all scholars of the Mongols and their society will be obvious, but I am particularly indebted to Paul Pelio from the scholars of a previous generation and the great Igor Durakovilts from the current generation. The principal sources for Genghis Khan are The Secret History of the Mongols, a court history by an unknown author, The History of the World Conqueror by the Persian historian Atamalik Juveini, written in the 1250s, and two other key Persian works, Rashid al-Din's Compendium of Chronicles, completed in 1307, and the Tabaqat-i-Nasiri by Minhaj al-Din Juzjani, completed in 1260. These Persian works contain much valuable information not available elsewhere, including eyewitness testimony. All three are excellent sources, but understandably, scholars differ as to their relative merits. Rashid al-Din is often preferred because of the scope of his work. The story of the Mongols is just part of a vast universal history, and his use of contemporary Mongolian and Chinese sources that have since vanished. Others opt for Juveini, though the response to this author has been mixed. While acknowledging its wealth of information from sources no longer extant, academic critics fasten on his cavalier way with evidence, his opinionated intrusions, his absurd magnification of numbers, and the inevitable tension between the deep dislike he felt for the Mongols and the need to disguise this because he was in their service in Iran. Juzjani has the advantage over the other two that he was an eyewitness of the Mongol conquests in Central Asia in the 1220s and that he did not live under the Mongol yoke and did not need therefore to choose his words carefully. From the safety of the Delhi Sultanate, he poured out his hatred and bile for the Mongols. Genghis is always the accursed one, but this very distance in both senses gives the work a unique value. The joker in the pack is The Secret History, written in Mongolian shortly after Genghis's death in 1227, an official record for the royal dynasty, secret in the sense that it was not divulged, disseminated, or promulgated, and its readership was confined to court circles. It is a curious, enigmatic work, shot through with ambivalence and ambiguity, the mystery deepened by the riddle of its authorship. Although it has been suggested that Genghis's adopted son Shigihutuhu may have been the author, the critical tone of many of the passages makes this unlikely. It is also improbable that it was written by either Tatonga, the influential Tangut pedagogue whom Genghis used as tutor for his sons, or by the great Turkic administrator of northern China, Qinghai, two of the other oft-cited candidates. The most plausible suggestion is that the writer was a close associate of Genghis's brother Temujin, who was positioning himself for a likely struggle for power after the death of the great Han Ogedei. Part sober history, part historical novel, part didactic allegory, and part hagiography, The Secret History has to be used with extreme care as a source, for it quite clearly suppresses or distorts key episodes in the life of the young Temujin. As soon as Temujin was transmogrified into Genghis Khan in 1206, the author seems to go off the boil and lose interest. The career of Genghis proper, the world conqueror, and his great conquests are dispatched in short order. Nonetheless, it remains a fascinating work. It has been called the Morte d'Arthur of the steppes, But this is unhelpful. There never was a King Arthur in the true sense, but there certainly was a Genghis Khan. The clumsy analogy presumably refers to the didactic element in Mallory. Others have hailed the secret history as an Iliad without the genius of Homer, but much the same considerations apply as before. If there was a trade war between Mycenae and Troy, it was certainly nothing like the conflict depicted in Homer. The battles up to 1206 in the secret history, on the other hand, were not only historical, but also probably described by a participant. Frank McLynn, Farnham, Surrey, 2015. Introduction. Baghdad in 1257 was still regarded as one of the great centers of Islam. The seat of the Abbasid Caliphate, it was to an extent living on past glories, for its halcyon days were in the late 8th and early 9th centuries. Al-Mansur, the second caliph, who reigned between 754 and 775, and the real founder of the Abbasid dynasty, had laid the groundwork. But the great wonders came under Harun al-Rashid, who ruled between 786 and 809, the fifth caliph. He made Baghdad a showpiece of the world, with mosques, palaces, hospitals, and irrigation works that astonished visitors and won him eternal fame. Perhaps the most famous building of all was the House of Wisdom, the world's largest library, also a research institute and translation center. The House of Wisdom contained volumes, and professors particularly specializing in the sciences: astronomy, mathematics, medicine, alchemy, chemistry, zoology, geography, cartography. But this was no mere MIT of its day. The rigor and erudition of the institute was counterpointed by the colorful city of bazaars and markets outside, where snake charmers, fortune tellers, and hucksters of all kinds throve. Harun al-Rashid's Baghdad, in short, was the one so unforgettably portrayed in the 1001 Nights. Under Harun and his immediate successors, Baghdad overtook Cordoba as the largest city in the world, but by the 13th century it had long since ceded the palm in the population stakes to Merv and other great cities of Khorasan. Even though Baghdad had declined since the glory days and had been on the wane since the late 10th century, an Islamic traveler around the time of the Norman conquest could still marvel at it. There is no city in the world equal to Baghdad in the abundance of its riches, the importance of its business, the number of its scholars and important people, the extent of its districts, the width of its boundaries, the great number of its palaces, inhabitants, streets, avenues, alleys, mosques, baths, docks, and caravanserais. Even those with jaundiced feelings about the Abbasid capital could not deny the grandeur that remained in the eastern bank city. As Ibn Jubayr, an Arab traveler from Moorish Spain, reported in 1184. It has magnificent markets, is arranged on the grand scale, and enfolds a population that none could count save God. It has three congregational mosques. The full number of congregational mosques in Baghdad, where Friday prayers are said, is 11. The baths in the city cannot be counted. City workshops produced superb silk and brocaded material. And in Italy there was a special cloth brocaded with gold named for Baghdad, and the cloth of silk and cotton called Adabi, after one of the city's quarters, was known by name throughout Europe. Baghdad essentially exported luxury goods: cloth, silk, crystal, glass, ointments, and potions. The city might have declined, but its prosperity was the envy of most. Yet there were always those, especially in an age when superstition was rampant, who regarded it as an ill-starred city beset by famine, fire, and flood. There was famine in 1057, attempts at social revolution in 1077 and 1088, religious conflicts that led to violence, and most of all, the ravages of fire and water. Major fires were recorded in 1057, 1059, 1092, 1102, 1108, 1114, 1117, 1134, 1146, and 1154. There was an earthquake in 1117, and floods in 1106, 1174, and 1179. There were large-scale riots in 1100, 1104, 1110, and 1118, and in 1123, a confederation of Bedouin tribes came close to capturing the city, which was saved only with the help of reinforcements rushed in by the Seljuk Turks. Inevitably, prophets and soothsayers interpreted all these bad omens as the harbinger for an apocalyptic disaster that would finally destroy Baghdad. The decline in caliber of the caliphs also seemed to point in the same direction. Al-Mustasim, the caliph who had reigned since his ascension in 1242 at the age of 31, was a man of poor judgment and little energy. A hedonist who spent his time in frivolous pursuits centered around women, music, and the theater. Like many such people, he coupled these attributes with haughty arrogance, deeming himself, on no evidence, to be a superior ruler. His attitudes exasperated his courtiers, especially the chief vizier, and there was much muttering in the corridors of power by malcontents who wanted to depose him. A particular concern was that he seemed heedless and insouciant about the growing threat from the Mongols, a mysterious people from the east who on four different occasions, 1236, 1238, 1243, and 1252, had made threatening forays in the direction of Baghdad, only to veer off at the last moment when they spotted more promising prey. But now in 1257, such threats could no longer be ignored, and the caliphate faced what in the 20th century would be called clear and present danger. The Mongols were coming, and this time it was no drill, no bluff. Genghis Khan's grandson Hulagu, brother of the great Han Mongke, the future Chinese Emperor Hubalai, and a fourth ambitious sibling, Erik Buka, was on the warpath. Mongke had ordered Hulagu to annex those parts of Muslim Asia, still not under Mongol control, and had decided on a sweep through the Western Islamic world as far as Egypt. The largest Mongol force ever assembled was put under Hulagu's command. Medieval sources speak of an army 150,000 strong, and by this date in Mongol history, such a host was numerically feasible. Hulagu struck first at the Ismaili assassins, the most dreaded opponents in the Islamic world. The political and military arm of the Nizari Ismailis, a breakaway Islamic sect, the assassins established their state at the fortress of Alamut in northwest Persia. Under the Grand Master of the order, known as the Old Man of the Mountain, the Ismailis trained their adherents to become expert assassins, murderers of the great and powerful, whom they always dispatched in public places to intimidate everyone with the terror of their name. The great Saracen leader Saladin was afraid of them, and notable crusaders had met their end from the assassins' knives. But in December 1256, they encountered a force even more terrible. Under Hulagu, the Mongols attacked Alamut, destroyed the supposedly impregnable fortress, and ended the menace of the assassins forever. The motive was said to have been an incautious threat made by the master of the order to Hulagu. Flushed with his triumph, Hulagu sent a message to the caliph requiring his surrender and personal obeisance and homage, the destruction of Baghdad's fortifications, and a huge sum in gold as tribute. Al-Mustasim treated this with the same lofty contempt the Pope would have shown had he received a threat from one of the great temporal rulers of Europe. He told Hulagu's envoys that he was the head of Islam, and as such superior to any mere temporal ruler, and that he had millions of the faithful from China to Spain to back him. "Go home to Mongolia, young man," was the gist of the patronizing message he apparently sent Hulagu, just 7 years his junior. Behind the caliph's back, the grand vizier sent a secret message to Hulagu, encouraging him to attack and assuring him that he would experience a walkover, since Baghdad was honeycombed with conspirators and fifth columnists who wanted the caliph dead. Hulagu sent a final warning. "The moon shines only when the fiery disk of the sun is hidden," meaning that the power Al-Mustasim boasted of could be exercised only on Mongol sufferance. This time the caliph sealed his fate by executing the Mongol emissaries, possibly the greatest crime of all in Mongol culture. Only when he had made war inevitable did Al-Mustasim take fright at the precipice on which he was perched and summoned his council to ask if there was any way Baghdad could escape the Mongol whirlwind. The universal opinion was to buy Hulagu off with so much gold that he would have to agree a peaceful solution. But instead he heeded his chief astrologer, backed by a bevy of soothsayers, who claimed that it was written that all who attacked the Abbasids were fated to perish miserably. The astrologer actually went into the details of the calamities that would attend Hulagu if he persisted in his sacrilegious folly. The sun would fail to rise. There would be no more rain. The soil would become sterile. A great earthquake would swallow up the invader's army. And finally, Hulagu himself would die within a year. The astronomer made the fateful pledge that he was so sure of what he was saying that he would stake his life on it. When the message was taken to Hulagu, his own astrologer confirmed the bad omens and said the caliph's seers were speaking the truth. For this treachery, Hulagu instantly executed him. When the caliph learned that Hulagu was unconcerned by the prophecies of doom awaiting him, once again he dithered, and this time agreed to the massive tribute in gold demanded. Hulagu brusquely replied that the time for such negotiations was past. Now he wanted to see the caliph's face. Hulagu advanced from his base camp towards Baghdad in November 1257 with great confidence. His huge army was supplemented by levies from conquered Armenians and Georgians, who had long since concluded that resistance to the Mongols was pointless, and more surprisingly, by Christian troops from Antioch. He also had a corps of elite Chinese siege engineers and sappers commanded by Guo Khan, at 40 the same age as Hulagu, and already renowned as an example of the way Mongols promoted on merit rather than birth. Hulagu reached the suburbs of Baghdad on 18 January 1258 and began the encirclement of the city, probing its defenses. The original circular fortifications built by Caliph al-Mansur no longer existed, but there was a 10-mile semicircular kiln-burnt brick wall surrounding the inner city on the west bank of the Tigris, interspersed with powerful watchtowers. The defensive brick-lined ditch was no longer effective, as it had been ruined by regular flood damage. Additionally, al-Mustasim deployed his high-caliber Turkish troops in boats on the river, providing an extra layer of defense. The Mongols advanced down both banks of the Tigris. On the west bank, the caliph made the mistake of sending out his 20,000-strong cavalry force to try to disperse the advancing marauders, but he reckoned without Mongol ingenuity. Their engineers broke the dikes of the dam along the Tigris and flooded the ground behind the cavalry, trapping them and then methodically destroying them. The Turkish soldiers on the river in front of the metropolis bore themselves much better and performed well. Hulagu was patient and methodical. He had his mangonels and catapults rain down missiles and naphtha at selected towers, particularly targeting the Persian tower. Because the area around the Tigris and Euphrates was barren of stones, the Mongols transported them from the mountains and cut down palm trees, which were then shaped into missiles. The Mongols dealt with the challenge of the Turks by crossing the Tigris at several points simultaneously and selecting the weak points they had identified around the semicircular wall. The Georgians were particularly to the fore in relentless sapping operations. Non-stop bombardment continued from 29 January to 10 February, when the Persian tower collapsed and the way into the city was clear. At this point, a formal surrender was arranged, but Hulagu refused to give terms. He waited for 3 days before ordering the final assault, to rest his men, and doubtless to inveigle the gullible city notables into revealing where their treasures lay hidden. He demanded that the caliph's astrologer be given up to him, taunted the man about the threatened disasters, and reminded him that he had sworn to the truth of the prophecy on his life. Then he had him executed. 13 February was the start of a 6-day sack of Baghdad. A Persian historian described the sequel with colorful poetic flourishes. In the morning, when the orange of the sun was placed at the rim of the dish of the horizon, and the light by sleight of hand had conjured away from the mercury blanket of the sky the imprint seals of the stars, Hulagu ordered the army to carry the torch of plunder and robbery into Baghdad. First of all, they razed to the ground the walls and filled the moat, which was as deep as the contemplation of rational men. Then they swept through the city like hungry falcons attacking sheep, with loose rein and shameless faces, murdering and spreading fear. The massacre was so great that the blood of the slain flowed in a river like the Nile, red as the wood used in dyeing, and the verse of the Quran, both seed and stem perished, was recited about the goods and riches of Baghdad. With the broom of looting, they swept out the treasures from the harems of Baghdad, and with the hammer of fury, they threw down the battlements headfirst, as if disgraced. And a lament reached the ears, from roofs and gates. Beds and cushions made of gold and encrusted with jewels were cut to pieces with knives and torn to shreds. Those hidden behind the veils of the great harem were dragged like the hair of idols through the streets and alleys, each of them becoming a plaything in the hands of a Tartar monster. For 6 days and nights the pillaging went on. Mosques were gutted, great buildings pulled down, people slaughtered. A sober estimate of the fatalities in the siege and sack of Baghdad provides a tally of 90,000 dead. 700 odalisks and 1,000 eunuchs were found in the caliph's seraglio. The worst act of vandalism was the destruction of the House of Wisdom, a literary loss to rank alongside the destruction of the great library at Alexandria. It was said that so many books were thrown into the Tigris that the river, previously red with blood, now turned black with ink and remained that way for several days. There is a suspicion that Christians regarded the demise of the House of Wisdom as divine vengeance for the treatment allegedly meted out to the Alexandria Library by Muhammad's companion and successor Caliph Omar in 642 during the conquest of Egypt. According to Bar Hebraeus, the Syriac Orthodox divine who was a contemporary of the destruction of Baghdad, Omar said of the Alexandria Library, "If these books are in agreement with the Quran, we have no need of them, and if they are opposed to the Quran, destroy them." The destruction of Islamic books in turn by the Mongols, who did not even have Omar's appreciation of the power of the written word, must have given smug satisfaction to anti-Islamic zealots in the West. While all this went on, Hulagu beheaded some 700 members of the elite and their families. Al-Mustasim himself he kept in an agony of suspense for a while. First he starved the caliph, then ordered him brought before him. The famished man asked for food. Hulagu handed him a gold bar and said, "Eat that." "No man can eat gold," said the caliph, in a plaintive echo of King Midas. "If you knew that," said Hulagu, "why did you not send gold to me at the beginning? Had you done so, you would still be eating and drinking peacefully in your palace." The caliph revealed the whereabouts of his public treasury, but Hulagu insisted that was not good enough. He also wanted to know where Al-Mustasim kept his private hoard. The desperate caliph was forced to divulge the location of this also. Finally, Hulagu grew bored with toying with him and ordered his execution. On 21 February, his personal servants were beheaded. The caliph and his son were put to death by a method the Mongols reserved for royal and princely personages. They were wrapped in rugs and then trampled to death by their own horses. After this, Hulagu grew tired of killing, announced that the survivors were his subjects and needed his protection, and called a halt to the massacre. The destruction to the city was devastating. The canals and dikes of the irrigation system had been totally destroyed, making agriculture and subsistence next to impossible. Baghdad itself declined in all spheres: demographic, political, social, economic. A garrison of 3,000 was left behind, what remains of the city was reduced to a provincial capital, and Iraq thenceforth was ruled from Tabriz. The survivors in Baghdad might well have wished they had perished in the Holocaust, for the Ilhanate imposed crippling taxes on them at the very time their ability to pay had diminished to perhaps one-third of its level in 1257. By the end of the 13th century, many of Baghdad's suburbs were deserted, especially on the West Bank. Its port Basra also went into decline, as the Mongols preferred to carry on trade with India from Hormuz. That was the end of the Abbasid Caliphate, and some historians say Islam itself never really recovered from the trauma. Throughout the Arab and Western worlds, people were stunned by the destruction of one of Islam's great centers. Baghdad joined the long roster of famous cities destroyed by the Mongols. Peking, Kaifeng, Samarkand, Bukhara, Kyiv, Moscow, Krakow, Budapest. A new round of embassies and travelers set out from Europe to discover who exactly these ferocious people were. How could nomads from Mongolia have become the conquerors of most of the world? Who were Hulagu and his famous brothers? And who was their father, Tolui? Most of all, they wondered about a man who had already passed into history and legend, the man Temujin, who had become Genghis Khan. Chapter 1. The Nomads of Mongolia. Central Asia is allegedly the cradle of so much Neanderthal man, nomadic pastoralism, warfare itself, even UFO sightings, but it is all but useless as an explanatory concept in history. We do better with the notion of the steppe, but even this is an umbrella term embracing a wide variety of terrains, differing in vegetation, altitude, and climate. Some writers rather crudely envisage the steppe as a continuum stretching from Hungary to Manchuria, the core or heartland of what the geographer Harford Mackinder termed the world island comprising Europe, Asia, and Africa. On this model, a mountain range blocks off the steppe at either end. In Europe, the Carpathians divide the Russian steppe from the Hungarian plain, while in East Asia, the Khingan Mountains separate the Mongolian steppe from its Manchurian epigone. Others prefer a dualistic model, with the low steppe comprising western Turkestan, the north Caspian, and the south Russian plains, and the high steppe consisting of eastern Turkestan and outer and inner Mongolia. As the name suggests, the high steppe covers the lands at an altitude between 4,500 and 15,000 feet, while the low steppe terrain is at sea level, yet others prefer a triad, with the steppe arranged in three rows or layers. The first contains all the lands from Hungary to southern Ukraine, the north of the Black Sea, and the gap between the Caspian Sea and the Ural Mountains. The second, or central steppe, runs from northern Kazakhstan to south-central Asia, where it merges with desert regions. The third is the great steppe land of Mongolia and northern Xinjiang, running along the northern fringes of the Gobi Desert to the Khingang Mountains in Manchuria. The entrance to this is through the Dzungar Gap between the Altai and Tian Shan Mountains. Still other geographers are unhappy with the whole idea of the steppe as the central organizing concept and speak instead of a distinction between outer Eurasia, Turkey, Iraq, Arabia, Iran, Afghanistan, Pakistan, India, Thailand, Burma, Laos, Vietnam, Cambodia, Indonesia, China, and Japan, and inner Eurasia, Ukraine, Russia, Mongolia, and the modern stans, Kazakhstan, etc. It should be stated also that even those who cleave to a horizontal explanation of Asia sometimes opt for the desert or for river systems as the important physical feature of the continent rather than the steppe. On this view, attention should be directed to the continuous belt of desert south of the steppe, embracing the Gobi and Taklamakan deserts, the Kizil Kum southeast of the Aral Sea, the Karakum east of the Caspian, and the Great Salt Desert of Iran. Significantly, at these latitudes, the spread of continuous desert extends through the deserts of the Middle East and Arabia to the Sahara, and is halted only by the Atlantic itself. Similarly, a horizontal view of the Asian river systems would reveal continuity running across from the Yellow River and the Yangtze via the Indus and Ganges, and finally to the Tigris and Euphrates. The emphasis on this steppe provides, in Mongolia's case, a horizontal west-east model. Some, however, say that the key to Mongolia is the vertical north-south axis, running from the tundra of northern Siberia and the Arctic Ocean, through the forest or taiga directly north of Mongolia, past the steppe proper to the Gobi Desert, through the mountainous regions of northern China down to the fertile valleys of the south. Accordingly, some experts prefer to differentiate the steppe forest of northern Mongolia from the steppe desert of the south. This view stresses the importance of mountains rather than the steppe lands, the Alashan, Beishan, and Kunlun ranges, the Pamirs with peaks up to 25,000 feet and canyon-like valleys, the Tian Shan or Mountains of Heaven with peaks up to 24,000 feet, the Khenti to 14,000 feet, and their westerly handmaiden, the Tarbagatai Range. The Altai Mountains have always particularly attracted writers about Mongolia, possibly because the Sayan Altai Plateau correlates with the forest steppe. The largely pine-wooded taiga is important in Mongolian history, and it is drained by four mighty rivers, the Ob-Irtish, Lena, Yenisei, and Amur. The subalpine valley of the Altai provide exceptionally good grazing grounds, with rich grass overriding the gravel, salt, and loam of the soil. Although there is no magical dividing line between the taiga and the steppes, nothing is clear as the abrupt transition from the Ituri forest to the open savanna in the old Belgian Congo, modern Zaire, or the Amazonian jungle and llanos of Colombia. Some travelers claim to discern a kind of no man's land of black earth dividing the two. Between the forest and the Gobi Desert lies the Mongolian steppe proper. Some even define it as the area between the northern edge of the Tian Shan and the southern edge of the Altai. Much of it is treeless pasture, with many areas below sea level, but there are high hills, often forested, such as Mount Burhan Haldun, sacred to the Mongols, in the north-central part of the region. These hills would have been very important, providing as they did both rich grazing in summer and abundant hunting resources. Crucially important to Mongolia are its rivers, though many are impermanent and evanescent. Water was always the most precious resource for the inhabitants. There are many wadis, some springs, in the southwest, some salt lakes and marshes, but it is no exaggeration to say that the area's great reservoir is Lake Baikal in the north, surrounded by high hills and noted for its plethora of seabirds, especially gulls. Mongolia is essentially a plateau occupying approximately 1 million square miles, set at a much higher altitude than the steppes in Turkestan and the west, ranging from 3,500 to 5,000 feet. Its central and ineluctable feature is the Gobi Desert, which comprises one-third of the area of Mongolia, with steppe and meadow about 50% and forest 15%. The Gobi is not a desert in the same sense that the Sahara is, as its surface can be grassy, sandy, pitted with scree or boulders, or striated with salt marshes. Some purists object to the very term desert on the grounds that the Gobi is primarily a dry steppe. On the outer fringes, a transparent veil of grass is apparent, and grassland is widespread and abundant, but as one penetrates deep into the interior, vegetation tends to be limited to scrub and grassy reeds. Thereafter, one confronts a melange of moving dunes, stable dunes, clayey plains, salt flats, isolated wells and desert trees such as the white saksaul, which can be used for firewood, and the ephedra. The Gobi stretches west-east for 1,200 miles. The south-north journey from the modern Chinese border to the Russian frontier is about 800 miles long and takes about a month of solid camel riding. For about half the time, the trek is over undulating grassy plains. Then comes a 4 days march of about 50 miles through deep sandy desert, punctuated by two high ridges of rock, colorfully described by one traveler, adrift in the hot expanses were small rounded hills riding like whales in silver mirages of water. This sandy desert breaks up the monotony of the undulating plain, but slows down progress. It is followed by a further week of gravelly plains, with the soil a deep red color, distinguished by brightly colored translucent stones and crystals. Nomadic peoples found the Gobi an eerie, unsettling, spirit-ridden place, and even later European travelers were disconcerted by the mirages. Quote, "The prevailing color was a kind of misty, half-transparent white, exactly like arrowroot or corn flour prepared with water only." The desert was uncannily quiet at night, when, as one writer mused, "the bright, unwavering lights of the Great Bear and the soft glimmer of Cassiopeia and the Pleiades stood out with a distinctness rarely seen in other latitudes." Clearly for the traveler across the Gobi, the primary problem was water. In normal circumstances, wells 10 feet deep had to be dug every 30 miles or so. Only with heavy rainstorms in summer was aridity mitigated. Dust storms were another hazard, but travelers failed to agree on their frequency and severity in the Gobi. Some claimed that there were choking sandstorms in summer and icy ones in winter, yet others, even with direct experience of the phenomenon, claimed it as a rarity. Mongolia suffers from both a harsh climate and lack of water. With a lack of adequate rainfall, on average only 10 to 20 inches annually, the land is too dry to support agriculture without expensive irrigation schemes, and this fact alone restricted the population of the land. Estimates range from a low of 700,000 to a high of 2 million, and the contrast with the population density of neighboring China was especially marked. The northerly latitude and remoteness from the sea mean colder average temperatures, less sunlight, and greater extremes of temperature than elsewhere in Asia. The winters are especially harsh, with temperatures below freezing for as much as 6 months in the year. Even within a single month, the entire gamut of weather conditions can be experienced. One meteorological study done in June 1942 testified to the wild variations. A calm and sunny early evening was interrupted by a 60-mile-per-hour gale bringing dust, fog, and 90% cloud cover. This storm lasted an hour, blew itself out, and was succeeded by a clear sky, with the night stars especially brilliant. Then, between 1 and 2 a.m., there were heavy showers of rain, and by dawn the sky was again clouded over. By 9 o'clock the next morning, there was fog, driving snow, and a temperature of 33 degrees Fahrenheit. Mongolia's great distance from the sea does, however, bring some compensations. Even though the country is in general very cold, there is little air humidity, and hence relatively little snow, with falls rarely exceeding 3 feet in depth. With so little air humidity to produce clouds, Mongolia enjoys 500 hours more sunshine in summer than Switzerland or the Midwestern states of the USA at the same altitude. And when the break in this weather pattern occurs, it tends to be violent. The Franciscan envoy Friar Carpini, who wrote about the Mongols in the 1240s, reported severe thunderstorms and snowstorms in midsummer. His diary for 29 June 1246 records heavy snow that day, together with hurricane-strength winds, hailstorms and dust storms, and the summer which could be so violently disturbed lasts just 3 months from June to August. September is already very cold, and in October, the first snowstorms can be expected. By November, the rivers are frozen, and then comes the six-month Niflheim, lasting until May. Throughout the year, the weather is both extreme and unpredictable, with temperatures ranging from 100 degrees Fahrenheit in summer to negative 43 in winter. Since there are no natural barriers to the wind, gales are always violent. One can be hit simultaneously by winds from the Siberian tundra and desert storms from the Gobi. Not surprisingly, the steppes look very different at different times of the year. Probably the most glorious month is May, for then the plains are covered with an immense green carpet, pullulating with flowers, especially red poppies, gentians, geraniums, islets, delphiniums, asters, rhododendrons, edelweiss, white convolvulus, and forget-me-nots that last until late summer. There is a huge diversity of plants in Central Asia, including 8,094 species of flora, of which some 1,600 species are desert flowers. Naturally, some regions of Mongolia are more favored than others. Some geographers distinguish two climatic zones, one in the west as far as the Altai and Tian Shan Mountains, and another in eastern Mongolia. In the western zone, there is little summer rain, but the winter is affected by Atlantic cyclones, with deeper snowfalls than in the east. In compensation, the mountain ranges of western Mongolia and the many rivers, mountain streams, and springs created alpine meadows and ideal conditions for winter pasture. In the eastern zone, monsoons bring moisture in summer, and a prevailing anti-cyclone lowering over the steppes in winter. The winters often see clear, sunny days and quiet, windless weather with very little snow so that livestock can pasture all year round. The eastern part of Mongolia is thus especially favored, And within this favored area, most privileged of all, is the area around the Onon and Karelian rivers, exactly where Genghis Khan was born. The Onon, about 500 miles long, rises in the eastern slopes of the Henti Mountains, the highest peak of which is over 9,000 feet high, the watershed between the Pacific and Arctic Ocean basins, and which perhaps contained the sacred mountain of Burhan Haldun. The Onon is a tributary of the Shilka, which in turn feeds the Amur. If the combination Onon-Shilka-Amur is treated as one river, at around 2,744 miles in length, it counts as the world's ninth longest river. The Karelian, which rises on the south slopes of the Henti Mountains, flows through the eastern Mongolian steppes, enters China, and empties into Lake Hulun. In years of high rainfall, the normally exitless Hulun may overflow at its northern shore, and after another 20 miles, flow into the Ergun River, the traditional border between Russia and China. 600 miles along the Ergun will again take one to the mighty Amur. If in contrast to the Onon-Shilka-Amur I just mentioned, one computes the Amur as the Karelian-Ergun-Amur system and regards it as a continuous river, the resultant stream becomes the world's sixth longest river, with a length of more than 3,000 miles. The Onon Forest, 400 square miles in extent between the rivers Onon and Karelian, and in time the Mongols' heartland, is thus a kind of oasis in the midst of the steppes, and as such a sort of wonderland. Here can be found a plethora of trees unknown elsewhere in Mongolia. Wild cherry, dog rose, currant, hawthorn, poplar birch, elm, wild apple, Siberian apricot, willow, ash, buckthorn, Russian ash, juniper, walnut, Acer pistachio. The climate of Mongolia has always ruled out significant agriculture. The inadequate water supply and the rapid disappearance of moisture because of evaporation and solar radiation are only the worst of the problems, to which should be added a short growing season, extensive swamps and marshes, cold and dry conditions, and a salty, waterlogged, or frozen soil. The people of Mongolia were and are mainly nomadic pastoralists. This simple phrase masks complexities, for there are pastoralists who are not nomadic and nomads who are not pastoralists. For example, the forest people of Siberia owned horses and were nomads, though not pastoral ones, while the gauchos and cowboys of the Americas were pastoralists but not nomads. Moreover, there is not even a necessary distinction between pastoralism and agriculture. Some peripheral peoples of Mongolia, the Ongud, just to the north of the Great Wall of China, and the tribes of the Yenisei, were partly pastoral and partly agricultural. Even more nuances and fine distinctions can be introduced if we bring in the notion of transhumans and non-transhumans. The usual distinction is that transhumans involves journeys between winter and summer pastures, but the pastoralists have a fixed abode in a village, say. In nomadic pastoralism, the drovers have no fixed abode, live in tents, and move with the animals from season to season. Although animals were private property, pasture was held in common by extended kinship groups, where the strongest tribes and clans claimed the best pasturage at the optimum time of year. Water was always a paramount consideration on the steppe, so that different nomad groups exercised proprietary rights to the key wells, with the outsiders having to pay for access. Typically, winter camps and pastures would be in protected areas with reduced snow cover, in low-lying mountain valleys, river floodplains, the southern side of hills, or even depressions in the steppe. This was the grimmest time, with the animals very weak by spring. Once the drying of grass and the evaporation of water heralded the coming of spring in late May or early June, the nomads moved to a higher altitude for the summer pasture, and their animals rapidly gained weight. Moving swiftly out from winter camp, they made at once for large pools of melted snow to water the stock. The distances between winter and summer pasture could be as little as 20 miles, but were usually about 50 miles, up to a maximum of 60 in favored locations such as the Onon-Karelian valleys. For those having to eke out their existence on the fringes of the Gobi, the journey might be 75 miles or even more. These journeys would be accomplished in leisurely tranches of between 5 and 20 miles a day, with the pace not pressed daily. Rather, the nomads would travel on alternate days or have longer rest periods. The summer camps were pitched on high ground with cool breezes. This was the season when yogurt, cheese, and the alcoholic drink kumis from fermented mare's milk were produced. Wool from sheep and hair from goats and camels was used to make thread and thence rope, rugs, carpets, and saddlebags. The Mongols were adept at making felt for tents. First, they beat the wool, then poured boiling water on it, and rolled it back and forth until the fibers locked to produce the fabric. Felt was a key aspect of the Mongols' tent, the gur. The more familiar word yurt was a later Russian coinage, as it provided insulation and protection against high winds. Autumn was the time to breed sheep for a spring lambing, but was otherwise a golden moment with the animals at their strongest. When the cold weather began, the nomads started the trek back to winter quarters. They liked to graze the animals on the periphery of the winter pasture until the weather became too severe, only transferring them to the heartland of the pasture when the temperature plummeted. The Mongols next made an educated estimate of how many animals would survive on the winter pasture and slaughtered the weakest and least hardy specimens. The meat would then be smoked as a winter food supply. The Mongols' diet was therefore also seasonal. Dairy products in summer, meat in winter. Naturally, the nomads tried to retain as many live animals as possible, subject to the constraints of water and forage. Winter was always a worrying time, as its severity could never be accurately predicted. A small-scale drover could find his wealth wiped out overnight from a combination of frost, drought, and disease. Since the animals were weak from the iron rations of winter and spring was lambing time, seasonal regularity was crucial. If there were freak snowstorms in spring, much of the stock, especially the newborn young, would die. Fortunately, this did not happen on average more than once in a generation. The big battalions, as always, did best, as the herd owner with the most beasts would recover more quickly than one with a handful. The Mongolian pastoralist had a plethora of problems to solve and was never far from a knife edge. Erosion, plant cover destroyed, and dust storms blowing away the topsoil, and mineralization due to the action of the wind and the workings of salt springs were serious problems. If these phenomena coincided with overgrazing, the result would be desert. In any case, salinity, alkaline soil, and general aridity limited the amount of water and grass available. This meant that there could never be any real increase in herd numbers, and by the same token, in human numbers. This is another way of saying that pastoralism unaided is bound to produce a steady and constant population. Moreover, even in such a steady state, nomads had to make precise calculations about water supply and the distance between wells and water holes, as the different animals they herded moved at different speeds and had different water needs. In this context, snow was a mixed blessing for the Mongols. On the one hand, it increased pasture resources, without which there would be overgrazing and ultimately desert. On the other hand, snow could be a deadly danger, as it covered up pasture grass and other plants, preventing livestock from grazing at all. Particularly fearful was and is the phenomenon known as zud. This involved repeated and alternating thaws and freezes, creating thick, impenetrable sheets of ice under the snow. Zud was particularly feared since it could affect the whole of Mongolia, unlike drought, which never had such a universal impact. The Mongol herdsmen had to balance all these climatic variables while maintaining 5 different types of domestic animal: sheep, goats, cattle, horses, and camels, all with different needs and requiring different management techniques. Unlike the Bedouin of Arabia with the dromedary or the forest people of the taiga with their reindeer, the Mongols were not single animal specialists. Their herding needed rotation of pastures just as much as agriculturalists needed rotation of crops. Horses and cattle need wetter pasture than sheep and goats, so require streams and fertile land. In Mongolia, this meant pasturing them separately from the other stock. Sheep and goats notoriously crop grass very closely, which means that larger livestock cannot graze the same land immediately after them. Overgrazing by sheep and goats was particularly serious, as their hooves cut the surface of the ground and exposed the soil, leading to wind erosion. The proper husbandry of pasture meant that the grazing lands had at times to be rested altogether and then grazed by different stock, cattle and horses, to give it a rest from the remorseless sheep and goats. It was axiomatic that no pasture should ever be grazed by the same stock year in and year out. The technical reason, apart from erosion, is that a steady accumulation of dung and urine from the same kind of animal, after a time ceases to have a fertilizing effect and instead becomes poisonous, not only providing less nourishment, but also enhancing the danger of disease and epidemics. All this meant either that special feeding grounds had to be set apart for cattle and horses, or that they had to be pastured before and ahead of sheep and goats. A closer look at the five domestic animal types can help to point up the complex problems the herdsmen and drovers faced. There was a problem right at the heart of Mongol culture, what one might term a difference between the objective and the subjective. Objectively, the most economically valuable asset they possessed were their massive flocks of sheep, but subjectively, it was the horse that was most prized. In their value system, the Mongols rated their stock in descending order of importance as follows: horses, camels, cattle, sheep, and goats. Yet 50 to 60% of the animals they raised were sheep, which were the mainstay of their primitive economy. Since early 20th century, Mongolia scarcely differed from its 13th century counterpart. We can put flesh on the bones, as it were, by adducing some statistics. In 1918, Mongolia had a grazing area of some 300 million acres, supporting 1,150,000 horses, 1,080,000 cattle, 7,200,000 sheep, and 230,000 camels. For 1924, the figures were 1,350,000 horses, 1,500,000 cattle, 10,650,000 sheep and goats, and 275,000 camels. By 1935, these numbers were respectively 1,800,000, 2,350,000, 17,700,000, and 560,000. Although there was a rapid increase in overall numbers because of special economic plans in the 20th century, the basic ratios held good, and the centrality of sheep is obvious. The Mongolian sheep is small, producing less meat than its European counterpart. Its wool was of little commercial value, but was used to make felt and clothing. The most important sheep product was milk, used to make either butter and cheese or kumis. The sheep proved its value during the spring move from winter to summer pasture, as it did not have to be watered, instead deriving the moisture it needed from dew and the grass wet from melted snowfalls. Spring was, of course, a risky time. Both lambing and shearing took place before the move to mountain pastures. The pastoralist always had to be careful. Sheep numbers could decline alarmingly whenever pasture was poor, as it was at high altitudes, in deserts, and on the margin of forests. Most of the surplus animals slaughtered at the beginning of the winter season were sheep, but it seems that the Mongols were frugal in their consumption of mutton and lamb. The Franciscan Carpini reported that a single sheep could feed 50 men. The traveler Simon of St. Quentin, in the course of a tirade on poor Mongol table manners, remarked, "They eat so little meat that other peoples could scarcely live from it." An average family traveling in convoy with a seasonal migration would typically possess 100 sheep, just a handful of oxen, 5 horses that could be used to ride into battle, and 3 other ponies. It was conventional wisdom that the optimum size of an ovine herd was around 1,000. Sheep were herded together with goats, another important nomad resource, both for milk and wool. Their advantage was that they could survive on pasture other than grass, but their demerit was that they destroyed small bulbs, as well as the trees the Mongols counted on for firewood or building materials. Pigs were entirely absent from the nomad animal inventory, though not because of any religious taboo. The Mongols were happy to eat pork or black cattle. The reason was simple. Pigs were not bred because they needed acorns, unavailable on the steppe, and because they could not migrate long distances. About 9% of the Mongols' livestock was cattle. The typical long-horned Mongolian cattle were used mainly as beasts of burden, drawing the carts on which the Mongols carried their mobile gurs, though sometimes also for meat or hides. They were rarely used as herd animals. The ox was the most typical bovine among the Mongols. They saw the advantage of allowing bulls to develop their full musculature before castrating them. Possibly the most prized of all Mongolian cattle was the yak. It used to be thought that the yak was used only in high mountain regions, but this view seems to have been discarded. Weighing up to 2,200 pounds and standing 5 to 7 feet at the shoulder, the yak was prized both as a beast of burden and for its milk, meat, and fiber. Its dung was also thought to make the best fuel. The well-known writer Vikram Seth has described the yak as a veritable machine for converting grass into butter, fuel, tent hide, and clothing. The most versatile variety is the heinog, a cross between a bull yak and a cow. This hybrid is particularly valuable as it can operate at both high and low altitudes, is docile, and yields better milk. The Franciscan Rubric and Marco Polo were also enthusiasts for the yak. This is Rubric. They have extremely strong cattle, with tails which are abundantly hairy like a horse's, and with shaggy bellies and backs. They are shorter in the leg than other cattle, but stronger by far. They haul along the large dwellings of the Moals, Mongols, and have long, slender, twisted horns, which are extremely sharp, so that the points constantly require to be sawn off. The cow will not let itself be milked unless one sings to her. They have a bull's temper, moreover, in that if they see a person dressed in red, they charge at him with a desire to kill him. However, yaks and cattle in general could not compare in utility with the camel, the Mongols' second most prized animal. The camel came close to the definition of an all-purpose beast, as it could work in almost all conditions and travel on any surface, but was particularly valuable in areas where the Mongols' beloved horse would struggle, as in the Gobi, Ordos, Alashan, and Taklamakan deserts. Camels have always had a bad press, particularly from the Victorian explorers and adventurers like Sir Richard Burton and Fred Burnaby, who remarked scathingly that a camel galloped like a pig with its forelegs and a cow with its hind legs. Yet those who know them well say they are affectionate and drawn to humans. Like dogs and horses, they instinctively ensured their survival by attaching themselves to man, the protector against predators. The Central Asian camel is the two-humped variety, or Bactrian. Naturally, among the Mongols, a horse-loving people, it did not have the kudos or importance the dromedary possessed for the Bedouin, even though Mongolia was probably its aboriginal homeland, but it was better-tempered than its one-humped counterpart. Since in Central Asia it coexisted with the wheel, it could not aspire to the position of indispensable ship of the desert. But against this is the fact that the only study of the camel in literature is Mongolian. The role of the Bactrian in Asian history is indisputable. In medieval times, it was common in Anatolia, Iraq, Iran, Afghanistan, India, Mongolia, and China, and made the Silk Road possible. The Bactrian's advantages were manifold. It has a lifespan of 20 to 40 years. It can carry loads of between 320 and 370 pounds. It can go 30 days without water if there is decent grazing, and can drink water with a higher salt content than seawater, though when water is available, it will gulp down up to 57 liters in one go. It is also a good swimmer. Its milk could be turned into camel kumis, and its hair was used as a staple in Mongol textiles. The Bactrian can travel at 4 miles per hour unladen and 2.5 to 3.5 miles per hour laden, and can carry its 300-pound-plus load for 30 miles a day. Yet it had several drawbacks as a would-be wonder animal. It is a diurnal animal, and on military campaigns it was sometimes urgently necessary to travel at night. Bactrians tend to stray while grazing, which makes them much more labor-intensive than sheep or goats. They need 8 hours grazing time each day. They hate to be left alone in the desert, and if they find themselves in such a predicament, are likely to trek on until they drop dead. If they slip on ice in winter, that spells death, for they cannot get up again. Even the very useful dung, or chips, used as fuel, produced a dense, pungent smoke, making their Mongol drivers bleary-eyed as they sat around the campfire. The animal that allowed the Mongols ultimately to conquer the steppes was the horse, that indispensable adjunct of those centaurs of the plains. As has been well said, a Mongol without a horse is like a bird without a wing. The steppe horse as a species was similar to the wild or Przewalski's horse. Horses were domesticated on the steppe as early as 3200 BC, but early civilizations used them for chariot warfare rather than as cavalry. Probably first tamed as a ridden warhorse by the Mongol tribes between the 5th and 3rd centuries BC, but on the western steppes not until the 1st century BC by the Scythians, the horse became an even more formidable weapon of war with the invention of the stirrup in the 5th century AD. Around 12 to 14 hands high, coarse, with a large head, straight neck, heavy coat, thick legs, heavy-boned, shorter, stockier, and sturdier than the destriers of medieval Western Europe, the Mongol horse was an animal of incredible stamina, capable of galloping 6 miles without a break. Although in the West its height would classify the animal as a pony rather than a horse, zoologists concur in granting the Mongol steed the status of a true horse. It can survive in temperatures ranging from 30 degrees Celsius in summer to negative 40 Celsius in winter. Mongolian horses find a walk too slow for their short legs and a canter too exhausting, so their natural pace is a fast trot. Their gait is ungainly, and they provide an uncomfortable ride for the uninitiated. Their supreme talent is being able to use their hooves to scrape away snow from the steppe surface, to reach grass or lichen below, and to survive on leaves from trees. They do not need to be fed beans, grain, or other fodder. In common with many other Asian equine breeds, they can subsist wholly on grazing, unlike proper horses, which would quickly weaken if left outside in all weathers and given no supplementary feeding. It was this all-weather capability that so often allowed the Mongols to defeat their enemies, since they could campaign in winter. When campaigning, each Mongol had 3 remounts and on forced marches rotated these every 2 hours to prevent exhaustion. Coupled with mobility, the Mongols could ride 600 miles in 9 days, though obviously not on the same horse. This made the armed nomads almost unbeatable. Yet even the magnificently tough Mongol horse was vulnerable to freak weather. The real fear for the pastoralists was that a late blizzard in spring with thick snowfall would hit their horses at their weakest after months of semi-starvation. Barring such acts of God, the Mongols could be confident that their horses would serve them well in every context. Such was the importance of the horse that the Mongols operated a kind of informal utilitarian calculus to estimate wealth and the value of their herds vis-a-vis other stock. They reckoned that each person needed 5 horses to live well, which meant that a family of 5 would need 25 riding horses and 4 to 6 pack horses. A gur containing 5 people that had more than 10 horses was considered rich. A horse was valued as being equal to 5 head of cattle or 6 sheep or goats. A 2-year-old counted as half a horse and a yearling as 1/4. The Mongols used mainly mares, as these were more docile and yielded the vital milk for making kumis. If short of food, they had a technique for making an incision in the animal's vein, drinking the blood, and then sealing up the wound. The very strongest horses were kept as breeding stallions, and each of these had 50 to 60 mares in his harem. The stallion, though troublesome, was very useful to a man on night watch, as he would not let his mares escape, and was as alert in this regard as a herdsman against wolves. Men, women, and children were all expected to be expert with horses. Children were mounted on horses at the age of 3 and strapped in even earlier so they could get used to the motion of their mount. There are examples of infant horsemen who could ride before they could walk. Mongols trained their horses to respond to calls and whistles like dogs, to obviate the need for any special corps of wranglers. They broke their mounts early to inculcate obedience, but did not push them to the limit until they were 5-year-olds. One of the reasons for the early breaking was to train the horses not to kick or bite. After breaking, the next stage was accustoming the animals to saddles and tack. Mongolian horses' tack comprised a simple bridle and a short tread, deep-seated saddle with short stirrups. These saddles had a very thick felt pad. The bridle was an ordinary jointed ring snaffle. The noseband was linked to the cheek pieces so that when the reins were pulled, the horse felt pressure over the nose as well as via the mouth, lips, and tongue. Mongols did not groom their horses, but let the mane and tail grow so long that it almost trailed on the ground. They claimed that this kept the horses warm in winter and warded off flies in summer. Moreover, if a bridle or stirrup broke, there was always a ready supply of horsehair with which to do the mending. Training then started with the horse at a standstill to get the animal used to noise, particularly the simulated din of battle. Next, they set the steed in motion while shooting arrows from the saddle so that it could get used to the different movements as the rider drew arrows from his quiver, moved the drawn bow from one flank to the other, and shot from different angles. The horse had to learn to keep straight while receiving leg signals only, as the reins were not held but knotted. The rider had to keep the legs rigid so as not to confuse the horse. Turning in the saddle was done with waist and hips. Other techniques involved getting the charger used to ropes and lassos being thrown, lances hurled, and swords wielded, sometimes very close to the animal's head. Strangely, the Mongols found that accurate shooting was easier at the gallop than at a canter. This was because when galloping on a free rein, the horse lowered its whole top line, stretching and lowering its head and neck, giving the archer a free field of fire. To ensure that their horses could veer and turn rapidly, the Mongols first turned them in a large circle, then gradually narrowed the range in ever-diminishing circles until rapid turns became second nature. Marco Polo in the late 12th century noted that Mongol horses were so well trained that they could turn as quickly as a dog. Then came the training in verbal commands. Noting the peculiarities of different kinds of horses, the Mongols preferred to use geldings if they were setting an ambush, as they did not neigh as much as stallions and mares. The Mongols were fond of their horses, and those that survived the arduous campaigns were allowed to retire and graze into their dotage. Only in extreme circumstances would they be killed for food. Since the horse was a precious resource, the Mongols were very solicitous for their welfare. They did not ride them in spring or summer, but turned them out to grass, allowing complete rest and relaxation. When taken away from the grass, they were tethered around tents and their grazing rationed until all fat fell away and they were ready to go on campaign. Always after riding their mounts, the Mongols unsaddled them and then held their heads up high to prevent their eating until their breathing was normal and they were cold. This controlled the eating process and prevented colic and lamentitis. Generally, they left their horses unshod, since the hooves of animals raised in a dry climate like Mongolia were harder and resisted abrasions better than horses raised in a wet climate. But once they ventured outside Mongolia, the Mongols often found that their steeds needed to be shod. The nomads' herds were, of course, not the only animal life in Mongolia. It has always been a paradise for wildlife, and in the 13th century, not even the massive Mongol hunts put a dent in their numbers. Even today, Central Asia as a whole contains over 800 species of vertebrates. Most of these animal species are represented in Mongolia, and in the 13th century, there were even more. Some of these were in competition with the Mongols' herds, and in two different ways. The nomads' livestock displaced many wild ungulates, red deer, fallow deer, gazelle, antelope, wild goats, the Siberian ibex, the wild boar, and it was notable that as soon as the Mongols drove their herds from winter pasture, the gazelle and antelope would congregate in thousands to graze there. Naturally, as nomadic pastoralists, it was the carnivorous predators the Mongols most targeted, especially wolves, which they controlled with their own breed of ferocious dogs and specially trained eagles. There were also bears, leopards, lynxes, and cheetahs to contend with, and, when the Mongols later expanded into other parts of Central Asia, they encountered still more big cats. In those days, the Asian lion was plentiful, and like their imperial predecessors, the Romans, the Mongols were fascinated by the inaptly named King of Beasts, to the point where they sometimes accepted lions as part of a total package of tribute from conquered nations. In the Mongol era, too, the even more formidable tiger was plentiful in Asia, especially along the river Oxus. Yet the Mongols' most interesting feline relationship was with the snow leopard, or ounce. Nowadays only found at altitudes between 11,000 and 22,000 feet, in the 13th century they were plentiful, could be tamed, and were used by the Mongols in their great dragnet hunts, sometimes amazingly being conveyed to the killing ground on horseback. They made very convenient pets for the Mongols, as they will eat large amounts of vegetation, grass, and twigs, as well as meat. There was also a plethora of small game that swam into the nomads' ken. Wild camels, foxes, rabbits, squirrels, badgers, martens, wildcats, hares, the extremely fleet-of-foot onager, or wild ass, and the Mongolian rat, described by one traveler as a soft, pretty little animal with a feathery tail and none of the disgusting attributes of the common Norwegian or English rat. Of the many rodents, including mice, gerbils, hamsters, and lemmings, the Mongols had a special fascination for the marmot, which they ate as a rare delicacy. Extremely hard to hunt and catch, marmots taxed the ingenuity of nomadic hunters, but apart from their role in the pastoralists' diet, they were valued because of a peculiar superstition. Though not so very different from that entertained in the contemporary USA about the groundhog, often classified in the marmot family, that one could tell from examining marmots what the weather and the seasons would be like. The Mongols often came upon snakes, particularly the Mongolian viper, but though venomous, its bite is rarely fatal to humans. It was a different story when the Mongols later expanded in imperial form, for then truly dangerous serpents like cobras were encountered, especially in Iran and the Aral-Caspian Basin. However, the Mongols always seemed to have an ambivalent relationship with snakes. Although they would kill vipers and milk them for their venom, which they used to tip poisoned arrows, in general they had a superstitious regard for what the Roman naturalist Pliny the Elder called this detestable creature, on the grounds that they were related to dragons and had power over water. In general, it can safely be said that the more new frontiers the Mongols explored, the more exotic or previously unknown creatures they discovered, whether the striped hyena of Afghanistan, the seals of the Caspian, the ostrich of Western Asia, or the venomous spiders of Turkestan. The one surprising thing is that their falcons and hunting eagles apart, they showed no interest whatever in Mongolia's teeming bird life. Although travelers' tales are full of descriptions of avian predators such as wild eagles, vultures, hawks, owls, as well as the innocuous partridges, grouse, swans, geese, cranes, spoonbills, egrets, pelicans, and storks, Mongol sources are silent. The same applies to Mongolia's 76 varieties of fish, which include trout, grayling, perch, roach, pike, sturgeon, and the huge freshwater salmon, or taimen, though here one can cite a deep cultural prejudice against fishing, which persists to this day. The consequence was that Mongolia's lakes were undisturbed by Mongol incursions into their fauna, and a great body of water like Lake Baikal could glisten undisturbed like a sea of sapphire picked out with white waves and snow-capped mountains round the coast. The physical appearance of the Mongols always intrigued and often shocked Europeans and Western Asians who met them. A Franciscan monk who accompanied Friar Carpini on his famous journey to the Mongol court in the mid-1240s described them as usually short of stature and slim, which he attributed both to their strenuous lifestyle and their diet of mare's milk. He described them as broad of face, with prominent cheekbones, and pointed up a hairstyle which seemed to be a melange of the Christian and the Saracen. On the one hand, they had a tonsure on their heads like the Franciscans and other friars, and from this they shaved a strip 3 fingers wide from ear to ear. On the other hand, on their forehead they wore their hair in a crescent-shaped fringe reaching to the eyebrows, and then gathered up the remaining hair and braided it like the Muslims. A later Christian visitor, William of Rubric, said that Mongol men had long hair behind the head, which they braided up in 2 plaits right up to the ears. While agreeing with Carpini that Mongol males tended to be short and slim, he found the women usually very fat. Females shaved their heads from the middle towards the forehead and had a particular fetish about noses. The smaller the nose, the more beautiful the woman was considered, to the point where they would even amputate the bridge of the nose, making the nose itself almost disappear. Both these accounts were confirmed in a famous description by Carpini himself. He referred to the Mongols as Tartars. In appearance, the Tartars are quite different from other men, for they are broader than other people between the eyes and across the cheekbones. Their cheeks are also rather prominent above their jaws. They have a flat and small nose. Their eyes are little, and their eyelids raised up to the eyebrows. For the most part, but with a few exceptions, they are slender about the waist. Almost all are of medium height. On the top of the head, they have a tonsure like clerics, and as a general rule, all shaved from one ear to the other to the breadth of 3 fingers, and this shaving joins on to the aforesaid tonsure. Above the forehead also, they all likewise shave to 2 fingers' breadth, but the hair between this shaving and the tonsure they allow to grow until it reaches their eyebrows, and cutting more from each side of the forehead than in the middle, they make the hair in the middle long. The rest of it they allow to grow like women, and they make it into 2 braids which they bind, one behind each ear. Such descriptions from the Franciscans were calm and dispassionate, possibly because bitter experience had not soured them on the Mongols. Western Asian descriptions of the Mongols' appearance were vitiated by the perception of them as the scourge of God, so inevitably they were described in Persian and Arab sources as hideous or frightful to look at. Emphasis was placed on the lack of facial hair, the quick, glancing eyes, the shrill and piercing voices, the hardy bodies. 2 witnesses may suffice. Here is a Christian Armenian of the 13th century. They were terrible to look at and indescribable, with large heads like a buffalo's, narrow eyes like a fledgling's, a snub nose like a cat, projecting snouts like a dog's, narrow loins like an ant's, short legs like a hog's, and by nature no beards at all. With a lion's strength, they have voices more shrill than an eagle's. And this is a Persian poet. Their eyes were so narrow and piercing that they might have bored a hole in a brazen vessel, and their stench was more horrible than their color. Their heads were set on their bodies as if they had no necks, and their cheeks resembled leather bottles full of wrinkles and knots. Their noses extended from cheekbone to cheekbone. Their nostrils resembled rotting graves, and from them the hair descended as far as the lips. Their mustaches were of extravagant length, but the beards about their chins were very scanty. Their chests, in color half white, half black, were covered with lice which looked like sesame growing on a bad soil. Their bodies indeed were covered with these insects, and their skins were as rough-grained as shagreen leather, fit only to be converted into shoes. Mongol women were a particular source of fascination to foreign observers. The accounts given of them ranged from arm's-length distaste, they were fat, they were ugly, they were indistinguishable from men, to grudging admiration. They endured great hardship uncomplainingly. They could ride horses as well as the men. They were expert drivers of carts, talented archers, and so on. Particular dislike was evinced for the garish colors in which they painted themselves, and particular admiration for the way they could give birth standing up and then carry on with their work as if nothing had happened. It was noted also that the Mongols respected women, as they were connected with the moon, and the moon was of great importance in Mongol religion. Despite the complaints that the women were unisex, androgynous, or epicene, the European chroniclers in effect contradicted themselves by drawing attention to the differential clothing of males and females. In the days before Genghis Khan and the luxury associated with world empire, the Mongols relied on clothes they could make from fur, leather, wool, felt, and camel's hair. The standard garb was an ankle-length robe with loose trousers worn underneath. To combat the elements, they had felt capes, fur hoods, leather boots, and felt buskins. The fur clothes were double-layered so that the fur was on the inside as well as out. Their favorite pelts came from foxes, lynxes, and wolves. Although there were no great extremes of wealth and poverty on the steppes, there was inequality deriving from the different size of privately owned herds, and the most obvious sign of affluent status was the peculiar headdress worn by richer women known as the boktak. Described by one observer as a man's foot worn on a woman's head, the boktak was an iron wire frame between 2 and 3 feet tall, lined with bark, and then adorned with red and blue brocade or pearls. Sometimes the frames themselves were interwoven with red silk and gold brocade. This slightly meretricious aspect of the otherwise grim and stoical Mongol woman can perhaps be read as compensation for the sparseness of her home. Before the time of Genghis, all Mongol tents were erected and dismantled at short notice. The dome-like tent or gur was made from a latticework of willow lashed together with rawhide and covered with 1 or 2 layers of greased felt. The gur was thus a kind of hoop of interlaced branches and supports converging at the top around a smaller hoop from which projected a neck like a chimney. The outer layer was usually covered with white felt or a white mixture made from powdered bone up to 14 feet in diameter. The floor was covered with rugs of felt, and hooks were fastened to the latticework on which food, weapons, and other items could be hung. The head of the household always faced the entrance, which in turn always faced south. The men sat at the western side, and the women on the east. Food and drink among the Mongols before the rise of Genghis Khan was largely a function of the narrow pastoral economy. That is to say, it was heavily dependent on milk and meat. In the summer, when mare's milk was plentiful, the Mongols actually preferred it to meat. But in winter, this milk became a luxury item, available only to the more affluent. Only in an emergency was meat eaten raw. It was usually boiled or roasted. The staple diet in winter for the ordinary man and woman was a gruel made from multiply boiled millet. Such was the knife edge on which the Mongols subsisted in wintertime that the nomads were not allowed to feed bones to their dogs unless the marrow had been extracted first. Everyone ate with their fingers from a common pot, and there was careful sharing of the food, yet all observers agreed that on the steppes one had to be a dietary opportunist, to be omnivorous, and to devour anything that came one's way. The Mongols would eat any kind of flesh, including marmots, as we have seen, mice, and other small animals. Some observers claimed that they would ingest any sort of protein except the taboo flesh of the she-mule, cats, dogs, rats, even lice and the afterbirth of mares. The English monk Matthew Paris, who was obsessed with the Mongols, claimed that they would eat frogs and snakes. The only general taboo was that one could never eat an animal that had been struck by lightning. It was also alleged that the Mongols ate human flesh. Although there is only one authenticated case of cannibalism during Toluyi's campaign in China in 1231 in a dire emergency, the canard persisted in Western Europe that this was a commonplace practice in Mongolia. According to the version of events, the Mongols cannibalized for pleasure or to terrify their enemies. The most outlandish allegation, popular in the West, was that the nomads used the burnt bodies of their elderly and useless fathers as a kind of sauce to sprinkle over their food. On the Mongol fondness for alcoholic drink, there was unanimity of opinion. Kumis was a staple of nomadic life. This was churned in a large leather bag hung at the threshold of the gur during the 3 to 5 months of the summer when mare's milk was available. It could be made from the milk of sheep and goats, but this produced an inferior brew. In the winter, the Mongols also made a light wine from rice, wheat, millet, and honey. Turbid and cloudy, kumis had a sting on the tongue like sour wine, but a very pleasant aftertaste like almonds. There was also a superior clear mare's milk known as black kumis, produced solely for Hans, chieftains, and high-ranking oligarchs. But since the alcohol content of kumis was only 3.25% at most, the nomads got used to drinking huge quantities of it. In the innocent days of kumis alone, alcoholism was rare and hence fights also. Alcohol became a serious problem later when the Mongols became exposed to real wine, 3 or 4 times as powerful, but not even Genghis Khan could do much about it, as heavy drinking was so completely ingrained in Mongol culture. Drunkenness was regarded as something to be proud of, an honorable estate, and the ultimate expression of machismo. Sated on their brew the first time round, the topers liked to throw up and then settle in for a fresh alcoholic binge. Yet it was not the vomiting that disgusted foreign observers, so much as the general filth and lack of hygiene among the Mongols, largely a result of the superstitious reverence with which they regarded water. William of Rubric reported that a Mongol would stop in mid-conversation and urinate, or, if defecation was called for, would simply move away, squat, shit, and continue talking. The harshness of the Mongolian habitat and the complexities of nomadic pastoralism help to explain the many potentialities of Mongol society, eventually actualized by Genghis Khan. Care of massive and variegated herds and flocks produced a number of consequences: adaptability and ingenuity of response and initiative, mobility and the capacity for rapid mobilization, military virtuosity, low levels of wealth and of economic inequality, almost total absence of a division of labor, political instability. Migration meant constant alertness and readiness to fight, since wealth in livestock is almost by definition highly vulnerable to raiding, raving, and rustling. Managing large animals was inherently more strenuous and dangerous than tending crops, so the very nature of pastoral life produced a hardier breed than would be generated by the peasantry. Migration in peacetime also produced martial qualities via the surplus energy available for fighting, since in a Pacific context, warriors could leave the minutiae of herding and droving to women and children. When the fighting came, it was less destructive than for sedentary societies that had to defend fields of crops, cities, temples, and other fixed points. There were other military spin-offs from pastoralism. Moving huge herds of animals generated logistical skills and the capacity to navigate through uncertain terrain, coordinating with far-flung comrades while doing so. The role of hunting was also very important. The Mongols began their hunting career with wolves and small animals, ruthlessly tracking down the former and trading furs from the latter for clothes and other items. But they soon evolved into hunters of big game, and their gigantic battues, to be described in detail later, were an important form of military training. Some scholars argue that, whereas a desert habitat is conducive to gradualism, the steppe habitat lends itself to rapid and violent solutions. Nomadic pastoralism on the steppe tends to isolate people and breed mutual incomprehension, so that raiding becomes an intrinsic part of life. Since raiding is a diversion from the primary purpose of pastoralism, there is an innate tendency for pastoralists to make their raids so savage and ferocious that sedentary agriculturalists, having once tasted the lash, will ever afterwards give in without a fight. One might simplify by saying that pastoral life engenders a kind of bully's charter. On the steppe, inequalities of wealth and rank were nothing like so great as in settled societies. In the Mongol world, there was no agricultural land, no disarmed peasantry attached to the land, no lords defined by landholding, no castles, forts, or defensive bulwarks, no stores of food or wealth except for livestock. Possession of wealth and control of territory was therefore very volatile, and it was impossible for a strong sense of property in land, and still less money, to develop. One consequence was the lack of specialization or division of labor in Mongol society. In particular, a distinction between herdsman and soldier did not exist, for every male Mongol was both. And, since both sexes tended flocks and drove wagons, the division of labor by gender was minimal. It is true that the men usually took charge of horses and camels, while women looked after cattle, sheep, and goats, but Carpini's attempt to insinuate a division of labor by alleging that men were bone idle outside warfare, while women did all the hard work in camp, is refuted by better evidence, including that from his Franciscan successor at the Mongol court, William of Rubruck. Rubruck's take was that both sexes were highly industrious, but that they divided up chores according to rational preferences. Men made bows and arrows, stirrups, bits, saddles, built dwellings and carts, looked after the horses, milked the mares and churned their milk, tended and loaded the camels. Women made clothes, drove carts, loaded tents and gurs onto them, milked cows, made butter and cheese, sewed skins, shoes, socks, and clothes. Carpini was misled because the Mongols disdained regular work, day after day, of the peasant kind. Idle sybarites such as Carpini describes would not have had their well-attested powers of endurance and ability to survive famines, nor would they have been tolerated in a culture where the leaders were supremely honorable about dividing food with their followers in times of dearth. The final aspect of pastoral society on the steppe, to be noted, is its gross political instability. Every tribal leader had to contend with the ineluctable fact that if he did not deliver considerable material success, his followers would simply melt away into the grasslands. No ties of kinship, real or fictional, clan loyalties, hereditary vassalage, territorial contiguity, or tradition could prevent this. The steppe world was a treacherous one, where allegiance could never be assumed for any reason. In the absence of feud or vendetta, political alliances and coalitions were fluid and ephemeral, with a bewildering crossover of tribes, clans, and even individual warriors. The only power a tribal leader had over his followers was the threat to appropriate animals and to massacre, enslave, and adopt women and children. But if a leader had such power, it is unlikely he would be deserted in the first place. And steppe tribesmen were brilliant at calling the bluff of blowhards or posturers. Chapter 2. Early Years. There had been powerful confederations, and even some empires on the steppes before the 13th century. Scythians, Alans, Huns, Avars, Kyrgyz, and especially the Uyghurs. But a historical punter, if such an animal existed, would hardly have bet on Mongolia as the birthplace of what would be by far the greatest of all. The Mongols began as an obscure tribe in one corner of Central Asia. Their foundation myth speaks of a mating between a male blue-gray wolf and a fallow deer who migrated to a high peak in the Hente Range near the headwaters of the Onan and Karelen rivers. From this union emerged a sole human male child named Batachihan. A dozen generations later, Dobun and his wife Alan the Fair produced two sons. After Dobun's death, she brought forth three more sons, whose father was supposed to be a mysterious being as yellow as the sun, who entered her tent by the light of moonbeams coming through the smoke hole. Once inside the tent, he rubbed her belly with his hands and caused the light shining from him to enter her, then left much as he had come in, borne away by shafts of light from the smoke hole. The five sons of Dobun, both the two he had actually begotten and the three born from a godlike source, each formed a clan once he had reached adulthood, and this was the origin of the massively complex clan system within the greater Mongol tribe. The youngest son, Bodinchar, founded the famous Borjigid clan from which the future Genghis Khan would spring. His great-grandson, in turn, was Haidu, the first ruler of a fully united Mongol tribe. Again, according to legend, the original Mongols were said to have been tall and bearded with light-colored hair and blue eyes, but by systematic intermarriage, they emerged as the people so well known for their short stature, black hair, and black eyes. With Haidu, who lived around AD 1050 to 1100, we finally emerge from the Stygian gloom of legend into the clear, well, fairly clear, light of history. The Mongols are first mentioned in texts of the Tang dynasty of China in the 9th century, and during the succeeding Liao dynasty, were reliable allies of the Chinese emperor. According to some accounts, they were originally forest people from the Taiga who had migrated south. The Chinese traced their origins to the Mengwu tribe, part of the Shi Wei Confederation in the years of the Tang dominance. By this time, they had firmly established themselves in the Onan-Karelen area of Mongolia. Two things changed with the Hanate rulership of Haidu. First, Haidu began to intrigue with the Jurchen people of Manchuria, who would finally overthrow the Liao dynasty in the early 12th century and establish the Jin dynasty. Then he decisively switched the Mongol economy from limited pastoralism and agriculture to full-blooded pastoralism, introducing new animals like sheep and camels. Some historians claim that this was a backward step and that the Mongols had regressed from the Uyghurs who ran farms and homesteads, yet despite his great abilities, Haidu bequeathed to the Mongols a poison chalice in the shape of bitter feuding between the two principal clans in the Mongol tribe, the Borjigid and the Taichiud. There were 13 clans altogether, but none as important as these. His eldest son, Bai Qinghor Doxin, was made head of the Borjigid as the privilege of the senior sibling, but the younger Charahai Linghu formed his own lineage, the Taichiud clan, as part of some obscure fraternal conflict. The desperate conflict between these two clans alone made it impossible for Haidu or any of his successors to emerge as the Han of a united supertribe. The history of the turbulent 12th century in Mongolia was dominated by relations with the new Jin Empire in China. The atmosphere of chaos that emerges from the sources is partly explained by the fact that constant warfare between the Chinese and the nomads on the steppes went on at the same time as intra-steppe warfare between the five principal peoples of Mongolia, the Mongols, Merkit, Tartars, Karait, and Naiman, who were all at each other's throats, as well as the continuing feud within the Mongol tribe between the Borjigid and Taichiud clans. Yet another factor is that the Mongol tribe did not simply consist of all the clans and sub-tribes whose native tongue was Mongolian, but that other tribes, Tartars, Naiman, and Karait, also contained sub-tribes who were Mongols in an ethnological and linguistic sense. The only easy way to differentiate the Mongols from the other tribes is to say that they were the only purely pagan tribe, the others practicing a mixture of Nestorian Christianity and shamanism. Medieval Chinese historians made a rough-and-ready distinction between the various barbarians on their frontier, dividing them into the civilized or white Tartars south of the Gobi and along the Great Wall, principally the Angud, the Karait or black Tartars who lived a non-luxurious and precarious existence on the steppes, sustaining themselves with pride at their superiority over the cowardly white Tartars, who had sold their birthright for a mess of Chinese pottage, and what they called the wild Tartars of southern Siberia, who eked out a living from hunting and fishing. The Mongols, insofar as they were identified separately, were placed by Chinese historians as being somewhere between the white and black Tartars. Only with the rise of Haidu did the Chinese realize they were something more formidable. The reality of the power structure in Mongolia was more complex. The most powerful nation was the Naiman, a people of Turkic origins who lived on the southern slopes of the Altai Mountains and the upper Irtysh River, and were gradually spreading over the Tarbagatai and the upper reaches of the Selenga and Orkhon rivers. They considered themselves the heirs to the Uyghur Empire, which had collapsed in the mid-9th century. Politically cohesive until the early 13th century, they embraced a form of Nestorian Christianity, mitigated by indigenous shamanism, and were culturally more advanced than the tribes of northern and central Mongolia. Next in importance were the Caryate, to the east of the Naiman, with whom they were allied. Also Nestorian Christians, who clustered around the upper reaches of the river Selenga and the Orkhon and Tula valleys. The Tartars, comprising six different clans who occupied the steppe region to the south of the Karelin River, were the Chinese secret weapon in the 12th century and have sometimes been called the gendarmerie of the Jin Dynasty. All Chinese rulers sought to palliate the threat from their dangerous northern nomadic neighbors by a systematic policy of divide and rule, and the Tartars, until the end of the 12th century, played the role admirably. As early as the 10th century, Chinese historians identified the subdue, almost certainly the Tartars, as the dominant tribe in eastern Mongolia. They were the traditional enemies of the Caryate and were said to have annihilated a Caryate army 40,000 strong in the early 12th century. The Tartars were particularly dangerous to the Mongols as they lived just to the south of their territories, the Mongol homeland being around the Onon and Karelin rivers. To the northwest of the Mongols, on the lower river Selenga south of Lake Baikal and around Lake Hovskol, was another warlike tribe, the Merkit, fortunately for the Mongols, divided into three branches, each with its own ruler. The Merkit were as fragmented as the Naiman were cohesive. The first half of the 12th century brought a significant episode in the history of the Mongols, with the Khanate of Habul, Haidu's grandson, sometimes derided for his pantagruel-like appetite, but clearly a man of great ability. In 1125, he went to China to attend the coronation of the Emperor Shi Zong, and was said to have shocked his hosts by his gluttony. It was probably on a subsequent visit that he committed the ultimate social gaffe, getting horribly drunk at a banquet, tweaking the emperor's beard, and generally scandalizing his courtiers. Yet the Jin did not make the mistake of treating him as a buffoon, for his able command of steppe politics had already made him a dangerous force on the frontier. So worried were the Jin by Habul that, having allowed him to depart in disgrace from court, they had second thoughts and sent an armed party in pursuit to bring him back and force him to sign articles of vassalage. Alerted to the pursuit, Habul lured the Jin posse into an ambush and slaughtered them to the last man. At this, the gloves came off, and from 1135 to 1147, there was bitter warfare between the Jin and the Mongols. The Jin once again tried to use the Tartars as their secret weapon, but Habul defeated them on several occasions, as well as doling out a serious check to a large Jin expedition that crossed the northern frontier into Mongolia in 1137. He managed to form a temporary coalition of the principal Mongol tribes, but was very far from being a supreme ruler or Khan of Khans. He was a temporary military leader, not a permanent ruler. The coalition was short-lived and in no sense exhibited the permanent features of super-tribalism. Despite having shown so much skill in steppe politics, Habul left behind a shirt of Nessus by choosing a Taichiud noble as his successor, passing over all his seven sons. In Taichiud eyes, this now made them not the Borjigid, the senior Mongol clan. Recriminations and jealousies between the two septs were now raised to a new height. Some scholars think that this event, rather than Haidu's misguided dividing of the realm between his sons generations earlier, was the truly significant event that weakened the Mongols and might have finished them off for all time as a serious political force. The Taichi you'd chosen was Ambagai. In 1143, he felt confident enough to take the war to the Jin and captured 20 of their forts near the Great Wall. Jin credibility was now at risk, and a large expedition was sent north in 1146. When this too failed, and the Chinese could never defeat the Mongols in a pitched battle, the Jin were forced to accept a humiliating peace, in which the nomads, for the first time, gave terms to a Chinese emperor. The peace terms required the Jin to accept heavy reparations of sheep, cattle, and grain, to abandon some of the frontier forts the Mongols perceived to be threatening, and to pay a subsidy. But the Jin had their revenge, and once again, it was the Tartars who did the dirty work. To achieve this, they were prepared to break the sacred customs of steppe hospitality. Ambagai, thinking himself the equal as a politician of Habul, went to the Tartar camp in the early 1150s to deliver his daughter as a bride to seal what he thought would be a clever alliance with the Tartars. The Tartars played along, but wanted none of Ambagai's schemes. They handed him over to the Jin, who crucified him on a wooden donkey. At the moment of death, he called on all Mongols to avenge him. This was an atrocity that was never forgotten, and its memory would surface 70 years later with devastating consequences for the Jin. Given the proviso that all dates in the early history of the Mongols are conjectural, we may tentatively place Ambagai's death in 1156. He was succeeded by Hutula, a Borjigid, thus restoring that clan as the tribe's natural rulers, yet there is much that is obscure about Hutula's election. Some say that the Taichiud broke away definitively from the Mongol Confederation at this point and separated themselves physically from the Borjigid by finding themselves a new headquarters north and east of Lake Baikal. Others claim that Hutula, in desperation, offered a fresh election in which he would stand, but only the Taichiud would vote. Yet another bizarre factor is that Hutula was Habul's son, yet had been expressly excluded from the succession when Habul nominated Ambagai. Whatever the facts of his accession, the upshot was a further ratcheting of the tensions between Borjigid and Taichiud. In Mongol lore, there was a supposed difference between Nirun, the Sons of Light, and lesser tribesmen known as Durlukin, perhaps something like the distinction between the guardians and the military class in Plato's Republic. The problem was that both Borjigid and Taichiud regarded themselves as Nirun and the rival clan as lesser beings. This caste difference was later strongly emphasized in The Bible of the Mongol Empire, The Secret History, where only members of the Borjigid lineage are regarded as proper Mongols, with the Taichiud as cousins or poor relations, equivalent to other such minor appendages as the Besud, Orinar, and Arulad clans. All of this is properly Mongol esoterica, but the practical consequence of the feuding was that the Mongols were fatally weakened in the 1150s and no longer the force they were in Habul's day. The Jin took full advantage of this, dug into their treasury to pay their gendarmes, and launched the Tartars again in a series of ferocious raids. Hutula fought 13 pitched battles against them in this decade, but could never achieve outright victory, probably through lack of numbers after the Taichiud desertion. He seems to have been an unlucky Han, for all the sources speak of his towering personal qualities. Said to have inherited his father's gargantuan appetite and to be immune to pain, he had powerful hands like a bear's paws and had a voice of a Boanerges worthy of history's other great bell-like declaimers, Danton and Pitt the Elder. According to one description, his voice resounded like thunder in the mountains. He could snap a man in two as you might snap an arrow. On winter nights, he slept watched over by a fire built of great trees and felt neither the sparks nor the brands that fell upon his body. At his awakening, he took the burns for the stings of insects. Kutala could eat an entire sheep and drain a huge bowl of kumis at a single sitting. Once, on the run from the Tartars, he hid among reeds, using one of them as a breathing tube while he lay submerged in water. The Tartars saw only his horse, which appeared to be sinking in quicksands, and concluded that the marsh had already claimed their quarry. Once they had gone, he pulled his horse out of the bog by its mane. Yet for all his great qualities, he lacked the numbers to deal decisively with the Tartars. After he had fought the 13 indecisive battles, the Jin finally concluded he was sufficiently weakened to be easy pickings. They prepared a great joint expedition with the Tartars, which achieved total victory over the Mongols at Lake Buir in 1161. It is unclear whether Kutala died in this battle, but shortly afterwards he was no more, and the Borjigid clan was close to extinction. The next Borjigid to take up the reins was Yasuge. There is something of a mystery about Yasuge and his origins. The official version in the secret history is that he was the third son of Bartan, Habu's second son, and thus clearly a member of the ruling elite. Yet Yasuge never ruled a Mongol confederation as Habul, Ambagai, and Hutula had done. He had a camp on the river Onan near modern Gurvan Nuur, where he commanded a ragtag host of Borjigid, renegade Taichiud, and other clans, but he was never powerful enough to be elected Han. His men were essentially guerrillas, a band formed of freelance operators and lawless wandering stars who chafed against the duties and restrictions imposed by kinship and broke away from their original clans to be free spirits on the steppes. Since life as an individual in Mongolia was highly precarious, such men tended to gravitate around a charismatic leader, under pressure constantly to deliver booty. As Yasuge was essentially a captain of condottieri, the suspicion had arisen that his inclusion in the genealogy of the Mongol ruling elite, as set out in the secret history, is later propaganda designed to enhance the glory and status of Genghis Khan. The probability is that Yasuge was the chieftain of a subclan with no connection whatever with Bartan and Habul, and that he was in Mongol terms a mere bagatur, or man of honor, the title habitually given to prominent nomads who were not of the royal line. In the 1150s, Yasuge was in alliance with Hutula, but he had his own goals and ambitions, and for this reason often disobeyed his overlord. Yasuge's key idea was that to rise higher in the Mongol hierarchy, he should ally himself with the Caryate leader Togril. The name means Jir Falcon, who needed allies since his position was under constant threat from his kinsmen. At the age of 7, he had been captured by the Merkit, enslaved, and made to grind millet with a mortar and pestle. He was rescued in a raid by his father, but 6 years later was again enslaved, this time along with his mother, by the Tartars. This time his role in serfdom was to tend camels. Somehow he escaped, but the two incidents strongly suggest that Togril was being set up by treacherous relations. Grown to adulthood, he was acclaimed as leader of the Caryate, but immediately came under pressure from his two jealous brothers. Togril decided to eliminate these pretenders to his position, but the two escaped and sought refuge with Toktoabeki, the principal Merkit Khan. It says something about the almost routine treachery on the steppes in this era that Toktoa immediately surrendered them to Togril, who executed them. Togril's uncle, disgusted by his nephew's cruelty and egomania, publicly condemned him as a murderer. The uncle, hugely popular among the Caryate because of his obvious concern for their welfare, Togril cared only for himself, called on the people to eject this tyrant, and they responded. Togril was lucky to escape with his life and fled south to China with just 100 followers. This was the unprepossessing individual Yasuge chose to ally himself with against the strong and vociferous opposition of Hutula, who rightly argued that the policy was dangerous folly. At the very time the Borjigid were struggling to fight the Tartars and the Jin and contending with opposition within Mongol ranks from the Taichiud, it made no sense to become inveigled into the politics of the Caryate realm. Yasuge was unmoved, and even went through the ceremony of Anda, roughly blood brotherhood, with Togrul. For 7 years, Togrul was forced to roam the frontier lands as a minion of the Jin. Finally, when he and Yasuge were strong enough, they invaded Karyate territory and overthrew the regime there, forcing Togrul's uncle to flee west for sanctuary to the Tangut realm of Shishia, the northwestern corner of modern China. But Yasuge's foolish involvement in Karyate politics did not complete the tally of his idiocy. He displayed his complete lack of political nous by starting a feud with the Merkit, too. Two issues are salient here. The Mongols practiced exogamy and would travel long distances to find a suitable wife, but were not averse to stealing women, even other men's wives or betrothed, if the opportunity presented itself. Yasuge, meanwhile, was a notorious womanizer, who already had one official wife and a harem of bedfellows. Sometime in 1159 to 1160, he took a fancy to a 15-year-old girl named Hoelun, who was then engaged to the Merkit leader Yehe Chiledu, Toktoa's brother, and abducted her in circumstances not entirely clear. This act of grotesque irresponsibility set off a 50-year feud between Mongols and Merkits. Yasuge's sons would thus inherit a vendetta which was none of their making, but which honor and culture compelled them to carry on. With Hoelun, Yasuge begat 5 children, 4 sons and a daughter. Temujin, born in 1162, Hasar, born 1164, Hasiun, born 1166, Temujin, born 1168, and the girl Temulun, born in either 1169 or 1170. Yasuge already had 2 children from an official wife whose name is disputed. There are also hints in the sources that this earlier wife might have been unfaithful. The 2 sons from the previous marriage were Begter and Belgete. It is typical of all things connected with the early history of the Mongols that there is no agreement on Hoelun's tribal origin. The consensus view is that she was from the Buryat tribe, one of the forest peoples, and even today the Buryats trace their ancestry to Genghis Khan's mother. Others say that the Buryat connection is bogus, even though there is the circumstantial touch that Genghis's wife Borte was buried in their territory. On this view, she was a member of the Olhunuud clan of the Angirad tribe, situated in the most easterly part of Mongolia. This would impart some rationality to Yasuge's abduction of Hoelun, since the Angirad were the Mongols' favorite target for intermarriage, so much so that the Mongols referred to them as the consort tribe. Temujin, the future Genghis Khan, was born in 1162. This is the only date that makes sense of the other events in the sources, though some historians, beginning with Rashid al-Din himself, have opted for 1155. At the other extreme is the eccentric view that he was born in 1167, which would require an entire recasting of all other elements in the traditional narrative. Nor is there any agreement on where he was born. One suggestion is that he was born in a valley called Gurvan Nuur, while another goes for Delun Boldog in Dadal, 350 miles northeast of modern Ulaanbaatar, a small village in Henti province in the middle of beautiful forests, mountains, and lakes, though this hypothesis seems to resonate far more with Plato's idea that a beautiful environment produces greatness than on any documentary evidence. The common sense view is that he was probably born somewhere on the upper reaches of the River Onon, or possibly the Orhon region, which is rich in game. Baljun Island, usually a peninsula on the Onon, and Mount Duyiran have been mentioned. Inevitably, legends grew up about his birth, including the story that he was conceived when a ray of heavenly light was beamed into his mother's womb, a story remarkably like the virgin birth in Christianity, as well, of course, as closely recalling the legend of Alan the Fair and the birth of Bodenchar. The legend preserved in the secret history is that he emerged from the womb clutching a clot of blood the size of a knuckle in his fist, which was read as a sign that he would be a great conqueror. There is a similar story about the birth of Tamerlane. The name Temujin has puzzled scholars, as it means blacksmith. If taken seriously, this would push Yasuge even farther down the social scale. The true explanation is that Yasuge named him after a Tartar chieftain, Temujin Uje, whom he had just captured. The idea was to transfer the chief's power to the child, but to make this effective, the man would have to be slain. The inference, then, is that Temujin's birth was celebrated with slaughter. Appropriately enough, cynics might say. The boy was brought up in the traditional way, learning to ride at an early age and honing his skill at archery by shooting at birds. In the winter, he sped over the ice on skates made from bone or wood, learned to track and hunt squirrels and pine martens, then graduated to bigger game such as deer. As soon as practicable, he began learning the art of falconry, considered an indispensable skill for a would-be future leader. There was no education in our sense. Temujin never learned to read and write, and the later great emperor Genghis Khan remained illiterate. Notably strong, enduring, and physically resilient, even so, he began to be overhauled by his brother Hasar, who was reported as a veritable Samson. As an adult, Hasar had shoulders and chest so broad and waist so narrow that when he lay on his side, a dog could pass under him. Like Hutula, he was said to be able to snap a man in two like a twig, and soon became the most famous archer in the Borjigid. Perhaps this was why there was always hostility and jealousy between him and Temujin, who far preferred the self-effacing Hasiun and his favorite brother Temuje. But the relationship that was most important to Temujin at this time was with a young aristocrat from the Jadarat clan named Jamuga. He and Jamuga played knucklebones together, and though their paths later diverged, both would remember the happy days of their childhood. It was a sad day for Temujin when Jamuga was taken elsewhere. He did not see him for another 8 years. But even at the age of 6 or 7, they had taken the oath of Anda, which supposedly created a bond more powerful than any mere blood tie. The Anda relationship among the Mongols was meant to unite clans, sub-tribes, and even different tribes and nations, and was thus a political affair, unlike blood brotherhood among, say, the Scythians or Vikings, which was a personal bond between individual warriors. Shortly after Jamuga's departure, when Temujin was 9, Yasuge decided he needed to betroth him to a prestigious girl. Mongols married early, and the earliest possible engagement of a son added to the prestige of family and clan. The traditional tribe for Mongol intermarriage was the Ongirad of southeastern Mongolia. Also known as Torolkin or the Nations, supposedly Mongolized Turks, the Ongirad had a complicated origin myth, lineage, and general mythology, all of which had had anthropologists scratching their heads. According to Mongol mythology, the close ties of Mongol and Ongirad were because they had the same family names, with the Mongols as the black family and the Ongirad the white. They first appear clearly in history in 1129 when they attended a meeting called by Yeludashi, the founder of the kingdom of Harahitai. To reach the Ongirad country from the Mongol homeland meant travel over mountains and then across the southeastern corner of the Gobi Desert. This was an entirely new experience for Temujin, whose rovings hitherto had been confined to the movement between summer and winter pastures along the valley between the River Onan and Karelin. The first part of the journey was at high altitudes amongst black rocks, thorny scrub, and heathland. Yasuge and his party trekked past Mount Darkhan, camping by night at the side of lakes where there was more chance of finding game. Passing through a variety of terrain that intrigued the young Temujin, they began the crossing of the Gobi. Yasuge explained that the desert held no terrors for him. Since it was autumn, the horses were in good shape, and the warriors were used to crossing the desert at this time of year to raid the Chinese border in present-day Gansu. True, there were water shortages, but if you dug about 30 feet down into the earth, you could find groundwater. Once out of the desert, the Mongols entered fertile country with rich pastures, orchards, fields of corn and millet, elm trees, and oases of willow and poplar. The traditional meeting place of the Mongols and the Ongirad was between Mount Chegcher and Mount Chihurgu. Yasuge had already explained to Temujin some of the complexities of the Ongirad connection. The Ongirad were divided into two main clans, the Nirjin and the Boskur. Although the Nirjin were usually considered the most important branch of the Ongirads, it was the Boskur and their chief Dai Sechen with whom they would be dealing. Dai Sechen greeted them cordially, but his mood darkened when he heard Yasuge's proposal for marriage. Nomads of the higher class were supposed to pay for their brides. Although he had prestige as a chieftain, Yasuge was cash poor, and all he could offer Dai Sechen was a single horse as a down payment. On the other hand, Ongirad women were by common consent the most beautiful on the steppes, and Yasuge had already identified Dai Sechen's 10-year-old daughter, Borte, as the girl he wanted his son to marry. Secretly indignant at Yasuge's poor offer, Dai Sechen raised difficulty after difficulty, intending ultimately to reject the suit after face-saving formalities had been completed. Here, for the first time, Temujin's personal charm made its mark. Alchi Noyan, the Boskur leader's favorite son, took to Temujin almost immediately and begged his father to accept the Mongol boy into his family. Dai Sechen finally agreed to the match, but only after setting a very high price on his daughter's favors. He would accept the horse as down payment, but Yasuge would have to come up with the balance before the marriage could proceed. In the meantime, he would keep Temujin with him and use his labor as interest on the outstanding debt. The live-in son-in-law phenomenon was common practice on the steppes when the bride price could not be paid at once, but was usually restricted to the poor. Though not averse to staying in Alchi Noyan's company, Temujin was shamed by his father's poverty and angry that he was being used as a mere pawn in a dynastic marriage. He remarked scathingly later about his father's behavior, "To decide a marriage based only on the amount of wealth is almost like merchant's conduct." Before Yasuge left on the homeward journey, Dai Sechen announced one morning that he had had a dream about a white jeer falcon clutching the sun and moon together with puzzling appearances by Temujin, which he interpreted as a sign that his prospective son-in-law would rule the entire world. This seems to have reconciled him to the impecunious boy, who appears to have spent a pleasant 3 years or so with the Ongirad. The inference is that he worked as a drover or herder, for the steppe peoples did not abide idle hands. The period with Dai Sechen was formative. By gaining a close knowledge of a people geographically far removed from his own, it may be that Temujin was unconsciously building a good foundation for a man who would later rule an empire. He learned many valuable lessons from the Ongirad, noting how often steppe feuds began with debts, how vengeance was a paramount motif, and how vendettas enforced narrow bonds of kinship, identity, and solidarity, and were thus inimical to the needs of super-tribalism. He noted the burgeoning trade between the Ongirad and the Chinese south of the wall, where furs, hides, horses, ewes, wethers, camels, yaks, and salt were sent south in return for lacquer, textiles, ivory, ornaments, and iron weapons. Dai Sechen spoke of the wealth and power of the Jin Empire, but Temujin reasonably asked, in that case, why did they simply not conquer the tribes on the steppe and take what they wanted without having to trade it? Dai Sechen replied that the Chinese were not a warrior breed, which set Temujin thinking they could be conquered by those who were. But soon enough, the halcyon days came to an end. When Temujin was about 12, word came that Yasuge was dead. It seemed that on one of his raids, he encountered a large party of Tartars. The sides were evenly matched, and the outcome of armed combat would have been uncertain. The Tartars, however, had recognized one of their old enemies and baited a trap. Since the two sides had met on Tartar territory, they invited the Mongol chieftain and his men to a great banquet, but put slow-acting poison in his food. The possibility of being poisoned was ever present in the nightmare world of the steppe. But this had to be balanced against the terrible insult that would have been offered the Tartars if Yasuge had refused their hospitality. Shortly after leaving the camp, he suffered agonizing pains in his stomach, lingered a while, then died. Essentially, he was a martyr to the nomad's code of honor. With his dying breath, he ordered his faithful retainer Mongli.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.